2018 Class 1 Long Island Championship. My name is Ben Turchin, and I'm joined by Joe Mulligan, assistant coach at Baldwin, for this contest today, and it's a pleasure to have you aboard. Joe, when we talk about these two teams, they are familiar with one another. This is their fifth meeting in the Long Island Championship, but Joe, Freeport, so far has been the better team.
Freeport 4-0. Floyd's definitely looking for some revenge, and it starts up front with their four defensive linemen.
In this game, the New York State Writers Association have both teams ranked. William Floyd number one and Freeport number two. They're both 11-0 in this game. If anything, maybe Freeport has a little edge here because they're not the number one ranked team, although William Floyd, they want revenge as well, Joe, to win this game.
Yes, absolutely. Freeport's multi-formation offense is going to come out looking to run the ball, and we'll see if Floyd can stop him.
Let's take a look at William Floyd and see their road to the championship game, see how they got here. In the quarterfinals, an easy win over Central Islip, 42-0. In the semis, they got over Sachem Beach, 34-7. But last week, Joe, they were down 10-0 in the first quarter against Ward Melville.
Yes, great test of adversity in the county championship. Floyd was able to come back and pull away for a big win.
When we talk about William Floyd, we talk about the quarterback for William Floyd, number one, Mack Driver. He gets things done. If William Floyd is going to emerge victorious in this game, it's going to be number one.
Yes, Mack Driver, he's a big body, 6'3", 220, and he leads the way for Floyd's running attack.
Let's take a look at the Freeport Red Devils and their road to the Long Island Championship. Again, Freeport went 11-0 this year. A quarterfinal win over Syosset, 48-14. The semifinal victory over Uniondale, 41-13. And, Joe, some people thought maybe Oceanside last week would have a shot after Charlie McKee's game against Farmingdale, but it wasn't meant to be.
No, Freeport has a suffocating defense. They tackle well. They're well coached, and they'll be ready to play today.
When we talk about Freeport, they are led by their junior, number 14, and that is Terrance Edmond. He's the quarterback for Freeport, and the ball will be in his hands most of the game today. What does Terrance Edmonds mean to this offense?
He runs it to perfection. He knows where everyone's going to be, who's getting the ball. He can run, he can throw, he does it all for Freeport.
So here you go, folks. We are underway in a second here with the Long Island Championships. It's Freeport, and it's William Floyd for the right to be declared champions. We'll take a timeout, back with kickoff right after this. Underway here, Nick Silva is deep, but it is returned instead by Jordan Clinton. And Freeport right away makes their present felt, Joe, on special teams. We talked about their defense, but special teams right out of the gate, not much running room.
Yeah, absolutely. All they do is swarm to the ball, and it showed on the kickoff.
So William Floyd, 11-0 on the season, looking for the Rutgers Cup and a Long Island championship. They are the lone remaining undefeated team in Suffolk County, believe it or not. If they win this game, a lot of people think they might have a chance at the Rutgers Cup. They'd go 12-0, but first they have to get through Freeport and this tough defense, folks. Believe it or not, Freeport's first-string defense is outscoring opponents' first-string offense, 5 touchdowns to 4. Mack Driver in shotgun. He's got running backs on both sides. Tyshawn Lopez in motion. The give to Silva. He's got room off the left side. And it's enough for a first down out to the 32-yard line. So, Joe, some good offense here to get going for Floyd.
Yes, right away, right to the ground attack. And they got outside, picked up a first down.
So it'll be first and 10 from the 32.
Silva scurries 13 to the 35 on William Floyd.
We know William Floyd likes to run a lot, and we should be seeing a lot of that today. Mack Driver, the senior quarterback, in shotgun. He's got his running backs to the left and to the right. It's the same formation that was successful on first down. Clinton in motion. Silva again. Some penetration, but this time the Freeport defense is right there to stop him. In on the tackle was Troy Ciraldi, number 53 for the Red Devils.
No gain, second and 10.
11:23 to go here. Just underway at Shewart Stadium, Hofstra University. Thank you for joining us on the Varsity Media live stream. Second and 10 after no gain. Shotgun again. Mac Driver, the quarterback, the senior. Silver flanks him. Floyd in a different formation this time. Driver's going to throw to his right. He's got a man open. Incomplete. Intended for Clinton, number 6. And Joe, just an errant pass on that one.
Yeah, absolutely. They went with a bootleg there. He had a man wide open. They connect on that. It's a big play.
Floyd faces third and 10.
So it brings up third and 10 from the 35-yard line. 11 minutes to go here in the first quarter. We're just underway. This is what Freeport does, Joe. They get you in third and longs, and they don't give up a lot of points. They're averaging less than 9 points a game on defense. We have trips right, bottom of your screen. And we'll see what Floyd comes up with here. We have a flag on the play off the snap. Silver's going to keep it himself. I'm sorry, that's Driver, and he's going to be short of the first down. Makhai Jinks on the tackle, number 52 for the Red Devils. We'll see what the flag's about. Possibly a legal motion. Freeport, I'm sure, will decline, and we'll have a fourth down.
Yeah, Freeport sent just 4. Expecting those guys to get after the quarterback.
Ball will go against William Floyd.
Indeed, it was on William Floyd, and I would expect Freeport to decline it here. So we're going to have, well, let's see, Joe. Let me ask. You're a coach here. The ball is, where is the ball? They haven't spotted it. It's at the 42. It's fourth and about 1. This might be fourth down territory.
Has been declined.
Yeah, definitely a tough call early in the game, but it looks like Floyd's going to punt and flip the field position.
You know, Freeport doesn't give up that many points. Is this an opportunity where you think maybe we're a yard away, we go for it?
Maybe. It's a long fourth and 3, so it definitely makes your thinking different.
In any event, it's going to be Floyd punting away. Jayvian Allen for Freeport is back deep at the 25-yard line. And now we have a timeout. William Floyd taking a timeout. They want to think about it. 10:31 to go in the first quarter. No score from Hofstra Stadium on the Varsity Media Sports Network. We are back. 10:31 to go in the first quarter. No score. William Floyd set to punt it away. The punter for the Colonials is Sebastian Paniccia. And back to receive Jayvian Allen. Only a sophomore. We'll talk about him throughout the contest today. It's a good snap. Kick is end over end a little bit to the left. It's probably going to sail out of bounds. It's going to stay in. It's a nice punt for the Colonials. And it's down finally at the 24-yard line. So the Red Devils will go to work on offense at the 24. Joe, for this Freeport team, offensively, you're going to see a lot of running today, not a lot of passing.
Absolutely. They're pass first. They'll use multiple formations and different guys getting the ball. So it's tough to defend.
Yeah, we'll see Jayvian Allen, number 2, getting the ball. Justin Lescouflair, number 3, who plays all kinds of positions, the senior. It does start with Terrance Edmond, though. We talked about him. Believe it or not, he's a junior. He played in this game 2 years ago in 2016 when Freeport beat Floyd. Remember, they've beaten them 4 times in the LIC. Floyd's looking for that revenge today, and it will start with Edmond. He lines up in shotgun from the 24-yard line. And now they'll look to Russ Cellan, the coach of Freeport, to get the signal. Jayvian Allen is deep, is the setback. And Freeport lines up with 3 receivers, but I don't think we're going to see a pass. And it's Edmonds. He keeps looking for some room. Flag on the play, gets a couple of yards.
Yeah, it looks like holding on that play. Mac Driver was getting penetration and was being held.
So if that's the case, it's going to back the Red Devils up. Slow going here so far. William Floyd was able to pick up a first down on their first series, but after that, not much. And Freeport here on their first offensive possession, possibly holding. So we're off to a little bit of a slow start here. But, you know, I think we expected that this was going to be a defensive battle in this game.
Yeah, definitely. With the front of Floyd, they really get after the ball too. So it's going to put the work on Freeport's offense.
So the call is indeed holding. It's going to back up the Red Devils. Will bring up first and 20 from the 14-yard line. And Russ Cellan, the coach of Freeport, discussed this week. He doesn't want to get in a situation where his team is first and long. And here we go right off the bat. His team is first and long. They don't have a lot of passing plays. They rely on the run. So this is a little bit of a setback here. Starting.
Yeah, and they're not used to this territory. You know, first down, they're usually getting 5, 6, 7, 8 yards. So we'll see how they react to this.
Of course, Joe, as an assistant for the Baldwin Bruins, played Freeport. So we're going to get a lot of your insight throughout the contest today about the Red Devils. Edmond's going to throw, and there's nobody around there. Allen was the closest, but on the far side of the field. And we have a pass, but I don't think that's what they're looking for.
No, and it was overthrown. We might have a flag on the play here.
I think it's hard to see with the lines on the field. No flag, I don't think. But Hofstra, as you all know, this is not a football college anymore. It's mainly about lacrosse. So the lines here on the field, if you're watching on the live stream, a little tricky. They do put the football lines on. They do the best they can. But some of the brighter lines, the yellow lines, are for lacrosse or field hockey, and that may confuse from time to time. So what looked like a flag is really a line marker on the field. Second and 18 from the 16-yard line after the incomplete pass. It's Edmond in shotgun, Allen in motion, top of your screen, and another flag, and they blow the play dead right away. Now, what is going on here with the illegal formations? I mean, we're the 12th game of the season. I would think we'd know this already, right?
Yeah, Freeport seems like they're a little flustered getting set, and maybe a new formation they put in this week and went offsides.
Well, the referee just waved the flag off, or the linesman waved the flag off on the bottom of your screen around the 20. So I don't think there was a flag. Maybe it was his mistake. So here we go again. Oh, it was on William Floyd, actually. So maybe offsides.
Maybe with the motion they jumped. And
boy, we are real slow going. We have not developed a flow to this game yet in the Long Island Championship. This is a game everybody was waiting for. Number one versus number two in the state. And we're trying to get a flow. Second and 13, shotgun. And it's Edmond looking to throw. Allen wide open. And he's got it at the 30. Down to the 20-yard line. So just like that, Joe, where we talk about Freeport not being a passing team, they hook up on a monster reception, and they're in the red zone.
Yeah, that's what makes their quarterback so good. You know, they ran a wheel route up the left side, and he was wide open, and he connected for a big play.
So the Red Devils are in business. On the 20-yard line of William Floyd with 9:37 to go in the first quarter. Again, they line up in shotgun. Three receivers. Edmond on the keeper, left side, has room. And he'll take it to about the 10. That's close to a first down. You know, you talk all week long and you prepare and you think you know what's going to happen in the game. And meanwhile, you get a big, huge offensive pass play to start the game.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm sure Floyd wasn't expecting that. Now they got to dig in. Play some defense.
Here's another pass to the flat, and that's Allen. He breaks a tackle. He's still on his feet, finally wrestled down by Jordan Clinton, but not before a Freeport first down at the 5-yard line. So the Red Devils are marching. It'll be first and goal.
Terrance Edmond's showing right now. He's got a couple nice passes, and he ran the ball well.
And Freeport is on the move. First and goal, they spot the ball at the 6-yard line. Just under 9 minutes to go here in the first quarter. Jawan Warren is now in the game, and he lines up as a tailback. Allen in motion, also in the backfield. Allen again, and that time Floyd stuffs the run, brought down by Keith Winfrey. We'll talk about Keith Winfrey a lot in this game. He's a defensive end on the defensive line for William Floyd, the senior. And one of the leaders, one of the captains, Joe, and right there steps up with a nice play.
Yeah, big play coming down the line, read the play well, and made a big stop.
So second and goal, they lost a yard from the 7. It's a fast-moving quarter. Just like how Freeport wants it. Keep the ball on the ground, keep the clock running.
And you can see early, they're coming out with a lot of different offensive formations.
Edmond will keep it, waiting on blocks, looking for the goal line, it's going to be short. Right at about the 1-yard line, I would say. The linesman is spotting it there. So we'll have third and goal from the 1. Freeport knocking on the door.
Down by 18, Andrew Minnelli.
There is a flag on the play. We'll see what happens here. Holding. So that's a tough one for Freeport.
Devastating. Third and goal from the one. Let's see what Floyd's got to push him back here.
Should be no-brainer on this one. So it'll be just like that. 1 yard away from a touchdown. Now it's going to be third and goal. No first down. They can't get a first. Must score. Second down.
Holding of the call is again Freeport.
Joe, can you still run the ball here? Or do you think a pass is in the works for Freeport?
No, I think the way, you know, they've had a couple good runs here, so there's no reason why they can't run it here and try and get back most of the distance on that penalty.
Well, Russ Cellan is not happy. He's on the sideline, actually on the field, talking to the officials, trying to figure out what went wrong on that one. He really did not like that call. And he's not going to win in any event. So Freeport's backed up, still second down from the 13, and we'll see what kind of trickeration or any tricks they have up their sleeve to get in the end zone here. And the clock has been running this whole time. Juwan Warren is in the backfield. Edmond looking left side. Has a receiver. That's Jordan Jackson. Jackson in the end zone for the touchdown. Just like that, even after the penalty, it doesn't faze the Red Devils. A 13-yard passing strike in Freeport. On the board first, 6-0.
Great, excellent throw. They ran a slip screen to the wide receiver. Plenty of linemen downfield blocking. Read the blocks and found the end zone.
So the Red Devils are on the board first. Here in the Long Island Championship, Class 1. Going for the extra point, Giovanni Martini. Edmond will hold. Good snap. Kicks up. Officials haven't decided yet. Still waiting. We have a flag. We have a flag on the field. Boy, this is, for a Long Island Championship, we've got a lot of laundry on the field here to start the first quarter. You think it's nerves?
Yeah, that's exactly what I was going to say. But, you know, both possessions for each team, little nerves. You know, I think once they settle in, we'll see some more efficiency.
So we have a legal motion. And we'll see what Russ Cellan for Freeport elects to do here. Would you still go with the extra point, or you try a two-point conversion?
I would still kick the extra point.
That's what they're going to do. So it'll be the same spotter and kicker. First one was good. And we'll see if Martini can make it 2 for 2. Snap is down, kick is up, and no good. He missed on the second, so the score remains Freeport 6, William Floyd 0, 7:40 to go in the first quarter. You are watching the Varsity Media live stream on the Varsity Media Sports Network. Ben Turchin alongside Joe Mulligan, assistant coach with the Baldwin Bruins. Joe, you know a lot about this Freeport team. You faced them many times. Does it surprise you that they are on the board first here in the first quarter?
No, not at all. The way Coach Cellan prepares his team, they're ready for every situation. And it showed there on that touchdown pass after a big penalty set them back.
So we do have a little bit of a flow now into this game. Freeport with the 6-0 lead. It'll be Martini to kick it off. And just as I say that, the officials now are stopping the game, and he's one of the side judges is talking to Keith Winfrey, number 8, right by the blue H in the middle of your screen. Now he comes off to the sideline. Nick Silva is back for William Floyd. And we should say that William Floyd will not be fazed by being down 6-0. They were down 10-0 last week to Ward Melville and came back to win. Here's Lopez. He's got some running room out to the 42-yard line, and that'll set up good field position for the Colonials as they take over for their second series of the afternoon. But Joe, I was just alluding to it. Let's talk about that for a second. Last week, they found themselves in a 10-0 hole in the Suffolk County Championship, but they had the wherewithal to come back and win that game. So I don't think Floyd, with their pedigree and with Coach Paul Longo, I don't think they're going to be that troubled by the 6-0 deficit here in the first.
No, not at all. They know what they have in their team. And like you said, they were down last week. So moving forward. They just stick with their offense, and I'm sure they'll be fine.
Things do start with Mac Driver, the senior quarterback, but they do have a good running game. Tyshawn Lopez, who just ran that back, and Nick Silva, will call his name throughout the contest as well. They line up in the same formation in the first series. And the give is to Clinton. And Clinton takes it to about the 48-yard line. Edmonds was in on the tackle for Freeport with a couple of other defenders. Troy Seraldi was in there as well. And Gerald Smikle, one of the captains for this defense. This defense is ferocious, Joe. We talked about it. They do not give up many points at all. They're averaging less than 9 points per game on the defensive side of the ball. So it's very hard to score against Freeport.
Absolutely. They fly to the ball. They're all great tacklers, well-conditioned. And you'll see great pursuit all game long.
We're under 7 minutes to play here in the first quarter. William Floyd, cool as a cucumber here. They're taking their time, setting up their offense. At the 49, second and one. And we've got shotgun. Here comes Clinton. He'll get the ball. Nice block on the left side, but that defense is there in full force. Dakarai Stevenson, man. I'll tell you, just as I was saying, nice block by Lopez as he did seal off one of the defenders, but you just keep seeing more and more Freeport Red Devil defenders to the ball.
Yeah, absolutely. Looks like Floyd's going with an unbalanced offensive formation, running away from it, and Freeport's flying to the ball.
We talked about this, folks. They are ferocious on defense, and that is their bread and butter. That's what Russ Cellan prides himself on this team. They're athletic. They're not all made up of seniors. There are some juniors on this line, but they get to the ball. And, you know, William Floyd, they're more physical. They're the bigger team. They're the more physical team, but Freeport, they're athletic, and we're seeing that here to start here in the first quarter. Third and four, very makeable first down from the 49-yard line, only 4 yards away in the shotgun. That's Silva. He's got blocking, and he will have the first down. Edmonds pushes him out of bounds, but not before the first down. Nice run by Silva there, and they keep the chains moving.
Yeah, Nick Silva, quick, strong back, got the yards they needed getting to the outside.
It's Floyd's second first down of the day.
Nick will move the six after a 9-yard
gain. On the 42-yard line, it'll be first and 10. Colonials looking for their first LIC win over Freeport ever. They're 0-4 against them. The last time these two teams played was 2 years ago in 2016 here at Hofstra. It was a Freeport win. And, folks, William Floyd has championships, just not against Freeport. They're very successful in the LIC against other Nassau teams. So they are looking for revenge. There's no two ways around that. First and 10. Silva again. Left side, good penetration by Freeport. And that was started by Arnold Cruz, number 7. He was the first defensive player in the backfield. And I don't think they got a yard on that.
No, look, they're trying to get to that outside, but the way Freeport flows to the ball, they're making it very difficult.
See where they spot the ball at the 43-yard line, so a loss of one will bring up second and 11. We're under 5 minutes to play here in the first quarter. Class 1 Long Island Championships. We thank you for joining us today. Ben Turchin alongside Joe Mulligan and the rest of the varsity media crew. Clinton in motion. And this time the give is up the gut for a yard or two. Looked like that was Tyshawn Lopez. And in on the tackle, Tristan Saab, number 55.
Also there, 54, Gerard Smikle.
So it'll be third and long, and this is a situation where I'm sure Floyd did not want to be in. This is a passing down here, Joe.
Yeah, absolutely. And Freeport loves situations like this. They'll let their athletic front four get after the ball and cover up top.
See if we get any pressure here by the Red Devils, a blitz. Looks like they line up in zone. Trips right, bottom of your screen. And watch out for Cruz. Cruz is in on a blitz. Silva picks it up. Driver has some time. And he's looking downfield, has a receiver, and he's open. Ronald Thomas for the first down. Boy, let me tell you, Joe, Nick Silva with a big block on Arnold Cruz on the blitz. That freed up Driver for the completion.
Absolutely. He saw him, picked him up, made a great block. Driver, with his athletic ability, scrambled around a little and found a wide-open receiver down the sideline.
Nick Silva with a very impressive start to the game. He's picked up a couple of first downs, a big block right there. And the Colonials, again, moving the chains. And on a third and long, you don't really see Freeport give up many third and longs. They're successful there.
Yeah, absolutely. And now let's see if they get back to their running offense for the Floyd.
Silver is the lone tailback. And now we have a stoppage of play. Looks like the chains are all mixed up there on the far side of the field. But I like the way the Colonials have come back here and answered the call. We talked about that. You know, this is not a team that's going to get flustered, and so far they have been moving the chains.
Yes, absolutely. You know, they were trying to run heavy first offense. Now they're spreading things out.
Silva up the gut, and he's met immediately, but breaks a couple of tackles. Still on his feet. Nice run by Silva. Finally brought down by Makhai Jinks, number 52 for the Red Devils. I thought he was going to get tripped up early, but give the Colonials credit. They are a gutsy team. They're still on their feet. They're plowing away here. They're not afraid of Freeport.
No, definitely not. And with their big front line, you know, they're just going to wear you down and keep coming after you.
Last week, Freeport shut out Oceanside. Charlie McKee, the freshman quarterback, everybody in the island knows about him and the game that he had against Farmingdale. They weren't able to do anything against Freeport last week. Not a thing. Shut out of the game. And here are the Colonials. They're marching down here on their second drive.
Yes, absolutely. And now with Mac Driver, let's see what he does with the ball.
They give it to Silva up the gut, and he breaks through, and he'll be close to a first down. It was second and four on that carry. Let's see if the referees line him. It does look like it's a first as the chain gang is moving. So, again, very successful and impressive drive here. They found something up the middle that's working. What do you think they're doing right now that's helping the amount move the ball?
I think simply they just spread out their offense. They're splitting out trips to one side, making Freeport cover, opening up the middle for them.
So it'll be first and 10 from the 14. They are able to get one more first down before the end zone, which is key here with them running the ball. See Driver lining up in shotgun. It'll be Lopez and Silva flanking him. Floyd is athletic. They have players. There's no two ways around that. And Silva off the right side looking for some room. There's about seven Freeport Red Devils waiting for him. But look at Silva. He's still going, Joe. This kid just won't go down.
Wow, great run. Nothing at the initial contact. Kept his feet moving and picked up probably another 3 or 4 yards.
He was finally brought down, looked like, by Troy Ciraldi, number 53. But, geez, seven Freeport Red Devils can't bring him down.
Great run. Kept the feet moving. Picked up positive yards on first down, and that's what you need.
So head coach Paul Longo for the Colonials has something going here on this offensive drive with just under 1:30 to go in the first quarter, down by six but marching. This drive started back on their own 40-yard line, and now we're at the 8-yard line, second and four from the 8. Silva again. Nothing doing that time. The penetration by Tristan Saab, number 55, got in the backfield with the tackle. That'll be a loss.
Great job by 55 coming down the line. Made the short tackle.
So it'll bring up third and six. Remember, they can get a first down before scoring. But it's third and six on the 10. Just under 43 seconds to go here in the first quarter. Very fast-moving first quarter in the Class 1 Long Island Championship. We've got a good one here, folks. Thank you for joining us. Matthew Wagner is the receiver on the top of your screen, but that time the give is to Ronell Thomas, and we'll see if he has enough for the first down.
Taken down by two Jayvian Allen.
It looks like the ball will be spotted at the 5. And Thomas comes up limping. That was his first carry of the game. And he comes up limping a little gingerly. So we'll check on him in a second. But it is going to be short. It's going to be 4th and 2. Joe, decision time, do you go for this?
I think here I go for it, yeah. Yep. Pick up the way they've been running the ball. Pick up the first down, give themselves first and goal.
That's the end of the first quarter. Welcome back. Second quarter action here from Hofstra University, Ben Turchin and Joe Mulligan. It's fourth and two. The Colonials are going for it. And it's Nick Silva, and he's jammed at the line of scrimmage. That was Jayvian Allen, and I don't think it's enough. The Red Devils are pretty excited. Do we have an official call?
Stop by two.
It doesn't look like they got the first down. So a big defensive stop, Joe, by the Freeport Red Devils.
Yeah, running right up the middle there. That's the teeth of the defense. So tough thing to do. So I don't know if Floyd wants to try that again.
But it was interesting is they had success up the middle that entire drive until that fourth down play. So obviously Coach Longo liked something, but give credit to the Red Devils when it mattered the most to step up on a fourth down play. They were able to do that. And we'll see that, I'm sure, all game long because that's how good this defense really is. So they will take over on offense at the six-yard line is where they spot the ball. Colonials have Freeport in deep territory here. Possibility, maybe they can create a turnover, get back in this game, although it's only 6-0, so it's still close. Edmonds in shotgun. And the give is to 21, Jawan Warren, not much doing there. Nice penetration by number 74, Gary Anderson, another captain for the Colonials. No gain on the play.
Freeport probably just trying to get some yards, get themselves out of, you know, by the end zone, but good stop by Gary Anderson for Floyd.
Tackle. They give them a yard, second and nine from the seven. There's not a lot of urgency here, play to play. A lot of waiting around, getting the call from the sideline. That's been popular over the past few years, getting the call from the sideline.
Yeah, Freeport likes to line up, see what the defense is in. You know, maybe go with a freeze call and then call another play based on the defense.
Another run. It's Warren, and he's close to the first. Nice run by Warren. And I think it'll be a yard or two short.
With
a nice gain there, so third and short for the Red Devils. See where they spot the ball. And now Freeport's going to line up just as I said that. Now they line up fast. Third and three from the 13. In shotgun, Edmonds to the flat. That's Allen. And nice tackle. Even though it's a first down, that was an open field tackle that could have saved the touchdown. Let's see who that was for William Floyd. Mike Tarry. Joe, if Mike Tarry doesn't make that tackle, Allen has a touchdown.
All year long, he's been plays like that. He breaks one tackle. He's gone for 60, 70 yards. So outstanding tackle to save a big play for Floyd.
On first, Edmond wants to keep it himself on the right side, bottom of your screen. And he's got room. He's got the first down and finally pushed out of bounds. But we do have a flag on the play. Clinton with the tackle, pushed out of bounds at around the 40. And Russ Cellan is not happy on the sideline. So this one's coming back.
Yeah, it looks like a push in the back. It's going to cost them a lot of yards.
I think it's interesting to note here, folks, as far as the officiating goes, both Nassau and Suffolk this year changed up how officials officiate the LIC. In the years past, Joe, they've mixed crews together. But this year, for the Suffolk games last night, Nassau officials did that game. Today, for Class 1 and Class 3 coming up later, these are Suffolk officials here at Hofstra.
Yeah, I like the idea of the same crew together. At least they're familiar with each other. I don't know, you know, mixing the crews, you know, not might not, you know, gel well throughout the game. So I get the concept of keeping the crews together.
And it's interesting that the visiting official comes here to the away stadium. First and nine from the 18. Freeport has three receivers on offense. And that's Jawan Warren in the backfield. So they get the call from Cellan. And now they switch formation, or at least, and here we go again. Now we've got a penalty, another flag. Joe, something is going on with the way they shift and their formations. Is it something that Suffolk officials aren't used to?
Yeah, I'm not sure because, they can look to the sideline. They can change their formation. Just quarterback has to make sure everyone's set.
So that's back-to-back calls on Freeport, and head coach Russ Cellan is not happy about it. Again, at least Russ Cellan is not familiar with this referee crew. He doesn't know this crew because these are Suffolk guys. Coach Longo knows them, but the Nassau coaches are not familiar. So who knows what's going on in this game if there are certain things that they're not used to that Freeport likes to do.
Yeah, and I know Coach Cellan will let them know about it, too.
Oh, yeah. First and 14 from the 13. Here's a pass in the flat. And that's Justin Lescouflair. First time we call his name. He's the senior wide receiver, really does it all, defense as well. Picks up maybe 5 or 6 yards, and it'll bring up second down.
Justin's very versatile, very electric with the ball in his hands.
Who isn't on this team, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
A lot of athletes here in Freeport. So it'll be second and 5, pickup of 9 yards. Once again, Freeport looking to the sideline for the play. So they line up quickly, but wait for the coaching staff to call in the play. We're under 9 minutes to go here in the first half. Still 6-0, Red Devils over the Colonials. On the option, Edmond keeps it himself. Nice penetration. Tackled by Keith Winfrey, and another flag comes down.
Yeah,
Freeport's happy about this one.
Yes, yeah, I think they're going to get a face mask tacked on to the end of that run.
And we do have an injured Freeport player down, one of their offensive linemen. That's number 62, Josh Grubbs. And he throws his helmet off, so he's not happy. Looks to be in a little bit of pain here.
There's
an official timeout. Why don't we take one as well? 8:45 left in the first half. Freeport 6, William Floyd nothing.
On this playoff journey to...
Back here at Hofstra Stadium, Sheward Stadium, on the campus of Hofstra University. Some good news as Grubbs was able to walk off the field under his own power, and we like to see that. So first and 10 after the injury on the 29-yard line. Freeport is down an offensive lineman, and we'll see if that affects them on offense. Edmonds keeps it himself, has some running room, tries to break free from the tackle, but can't do that. Nice pursuit by DJ Bennett, number 11. In on the tackle, that allowed number 22, Jazad Hall, to come in and clean it up. So nice open field tackling by Floyd. And Joe, we've seen that quite a bit here by the Floyd defense. They're physical.
Yeah, absolutely. Freeport went with basically 5 receivers, empty back set, and looking to run with their quarterback trying to get in the outside. But Floyd was ready and showed great pursuit to the ball.
Second and 10 from the 29-yard line. Freeport still leading this game 6-0. Low scoring. We expected that. Edmonds drops back. He's got Allen breaking free, but the pass is going to sail wide. Boy, Allen, what an athletic player this guy is. And he's calling for a flag. I think he was held up a little bit by DJ Bennett just to slow him down. I don't know if it was inside 5 yards. But, Joe, these Freeport players, they are so athletic. Allen broke free for sure. He was wide open.
Yeah, I think he has legitimate right there. He was held, and the quarterback threw it probably where he should have been if he wasn't held.
So Floyd may have gotten away with one there. It'll be 3rd and 10. Big opportunity here for the Colonials. They have played well in this game. They were 2 yards away from a first on the 6-yard line, so they were 6 yards away from possibly tying this game up. And their defense has been playing very well here in the first half. So here's a 3rd and long, and we'll see if the Colonials can stop Freeport on this drive. You got Allen in motion, and now we have a timeout. Coach Shellen's going to take a timeout here. Wasn't happy with the way the offense was situated there, so he's going to think about this one. Let's reset a little bit here on third down. If you're just tuning in here on the live stream, Freeport on a big pass play, close to a 50-yard pass play from Terrance Edmond to Jayvian Allen, set them up for their first touchdown. And then the Colonials, a drive ago, had an opportunity to punch it in, but they came up short on 4th and 2. And that's where we stand in this game. Joe, what have you seen so far from both teams? Would you say the defense has come to play here today?
Yeah, definitely. You know, Freeport's normal. They're showing their normal multiple formation, trying to run the ball, spread it out to their receivers on some quick passes. And Floyd, they're trying some smash-mouth football, but have found that Freeport really gets after the football.
Indeed they do, and they're going to line up again here on a 3rd and 10. Looks like Coach Cellan has the team in the right formation this time around. It's Edmond in shotgun. It's Allen flanking him to the right. Little play action. And this is Lescouflair. Lescouflair breaking tackles out to the 40-yard line. Good enough for a first down. And he'll carry it all the way out to the 46-yard line. P.K. Kite in on the tackle, number 10 for the Colonials, but not before a Freeport first down. Joe, that was a big play for the Red Devils, keeping the chains moving.
Yeah, get your electric receivers the ball in space and let them do their thing. But Floyd is tackling well, preventing them from big plays.
Freeport lining up quick, and again, another flag. So again, this has got to be the fourth or fifth time we've seen a flag on option play by the Red Devils. Joe, as a coach, what's going on here, and how can Russ Cellan correct this?
I think, you know, the Freeport, they want to push the tempo of play, but they just have to be set, you know, before running that next play, and it just cost them 5 yards.
And let me ask you this about officiating. Is there a familiarity in your own county with the officials? I mean, I know that coaches are allowed to review and select, and there's a system. But do you think there's a factor here because he's not familiar with these guys?
Yeah, absolutely. I know, you know, just like a lot of the coaches have been doing it for a long time, same with the officials. So, you know, officials might know your offense, and the sideline ref with Freeport doesn't know as much what they're doing.
So it's 1st and 15. Edmonds gets it out quick to Allen, and great pursuit by Floyd right there. A couple of Floyd Colonials in on the tackle. Looks like Nick Silva was the first one there. We mentioned Nick Silva's name on defense for the first time today. Great athlete. And that's a big play. So it's 2nd and long here again for Freeport. 2nd and 16 from the 42. Let's pay attention to how Freeport motions here on this play. You got a receiver on the bottom of the screen, one on the top, and we'll see if there's any motion here before the snap. No motion at all. Allen, no, it's Edmonds, keeps it himself up the middle, but a nice tackle that time by P.K. Kite in behind the line of scrimmage. Great pursuit, Joe, and I don't think Edmond got much on that.
No, great job by Floyd's defensive front, not allowing any big yards.
So it should be 3rd and 15 from the 43. Remember, Freeport just converted a 3rd and long a few plays ago. So here comes Floyd with another opportunity to stop the Red Devils and get the ball back here with plenty of time in the first half. 6:30 to go in the second quarter. 3rd and 15 from the 43. Edmonds in shotgun, steps up, going downfield, looking for Allen again, and it's intercepted. William Floyd with the pick. DJ Bennett, number 11, with great coverage on Allen and a big turnover for the Colonials.
Absolutely. Step for step with the Freeport receiver. He turned right at the perfect time, intercepted the ball. Now let's see what Floyd can do on offense.
Joe, that was a huge turnover for the Colonials on a big third down play. They get the ball back with 6:11 to go here. I'm sorry, 6:10, close enough, to go here in the first half. And that's got to be a momentum builder because they have been in this game this whole time, and they stopped Freeport in their tracks on a 3rd and long. And now we'll see, what can they do offensively here to get the sticks moving a little bit?
Yeah, Freeport took a big shot there, hoping, you know, either they're came up with a big play, maybe a pass interference, but now it's Floyd's ball.
So they'll line up in four receivers, rather. We'll see if they move the ball through the air. Nick Silva's the tailback, and Mac Driver puts his man in motion. Silva gets the ball, again, up the middle. They like that play all day today, and it works for about possibly a first down. It is a 10-yard gain by Silva, again, going up the middle.
Yeah, they went evens, four receivers. Simple dive up the middle and picked up the first down. Tough run.
So that has seemed to be working for the Colonials.
10-yard gain.
As they pick up the first and 10. See where they spot the football. About the 22-yard line. Clock continues to roll. So That's something you have to be aware of. Floyd has two timeouts left in the half. At some point, you'd think they would put it up in the air. They do line up four receivers, two to the top, two on the bottom. Silva, again, the tailback. This is Clinton in motion. Silva's going to get it. No, it's Driver. He keeps it himself, breaking a tackle, and Edmond undercuts him at about the 30-yard line. So a nice option play there. Pickup of about 5 yards will bring up second and five from the 30. Joe, does Floyd have enough time here in the first half with this kind of offense to score? With 5:30 to go.
I think they do have enough time. You know, they're getting 4 or 5 yards now a play. Maybe at some point they'll try for a deep ball to move the ball that much further closer to the end zone.
Driver went out of bounds, so the clock stops. They call it a second and four from the 28, and it's the same formation we've seen on this drive. That's Clinton. And Driver keeps it himself. Some pursuit by Freeport, but he's still on his feet. Edmonds, boy, let's talk about Terrance Edmond. He is everywhere. Yeah. Not only the quarterback, but he's making every tackle so far on the field.
He is. Yeah, Floyd's running the ball real well right now, and Edmonds is both sides of the ball for Freeport making plays.
What is it about this player? A junior quarterback, the next great quarterback in the pantheon of Freeport quarterbacks, but defensively as well. He's just an all-around great athlete.
Yeah, on offense, you know, they want their best player with the ball every play, making plays, and he's showing up playing corner now for the Freeport Red Devils.
So it's a first down for the Colonials on the 38-yard line. Clock shows 5:16 and counting. And Floyd lines up in shotgun, and that's Clinton. We've seen him motion throughout the game. Silva, nothing doing that time. Penetration by the Red Devils. Let's see who was in first. That was number 12, Dakarai Stevenson. And Tristan Saab, we've mentioned his name a couple of times. He was in on that tackle as well. And Miles Norris, number 61. So that time, Joe, Fairport able to penetrate the offensive line.
Yeah, great job pursuing to the ball by Freeport. I thought that Floyd had shown something there with this formation, but nowhere to go on that down.
Second and 10 from the 38-yard line. Floyd is huddling with the clock continuing to move at 4:28. So both of these teams really want to hold on to the ball, maintain that possession, keep it away from the other team as much as possible. Driver looking up top, has a completed guy, and that's Clinton. Clinton is into Freeport territory, taken down at the 40-yard line by Jayvian Allen, rather, and Allen slow to get up, now finally does. So a big first down play and a nice catch that time by Jordan Clinton, the senior wide receiver.
Floyd went with a bootleg there. Good rollout by Mack. Driver turned, found his wide open receiver down the middle of the field.
Floyd has been able to move the ball in this game. It's not like Freeport has shut them down. They have on the scoreboard. But, you know, 20-yard line to 20-yard line, Floyd can move it.
Yeah, and they got a great drive going here, and they still have just under 4 minutes left, and they're into Freeport territory.
Yeah, plenty of time now that they're in Freeport territory with two timeouts and 3:40 to go. Lots of time here for the Colonials. They'd love to put one on the board and go into the locker room. Clinton again in motion, and he'll be wrapped down at the 34-yard line. Once again, Dakarai Stevenson in on the action there, and it looks like Justin Lescouflair helping in on the tackle. The clock stopped. And now it wasn't a first down, so I was curious as to why the clock would stop there.
There was a player that lost his helmet, so I wasn't sure if they were making sure he's got to come out for one play, so it's back rolling again.
And he did come out. And we'll try to tell you who that player was. He's on the sideline, but he looks like it was 52, Makhai Jinks. So I'm sure he'll get right back into the game. That's Ramel Thomas in motion, and this is Silva, and Silva's met immediately by Miles Norris for the Red Devils. Not much doing there, a nice tackle by Miles Norris, the junior. And what's going on here by the 20-yard line? Looks like Jayvian Allen is the official tying his shoe.
Yeah, I can say I've never seen that before. But
you like to see that. Everybody helping each other out, right? The clock is rolling. We're under 2:30, but Floyd has two timeouts remaining here in the first half, so they can stop it. But they don't show a lot of urgency here. At the 33-yard line, we've got 3rd and 5. I'm sure this is two down territory.
Absolutely.
Floyd shows 4 receivers, and they've got Silva in the backfield. This is Thomas in motion. Driver's going up top. He's got a receiver. It's Clinton, and it's bobbled. Nice pass breakup by Edmond. He was right there, and the coverage today by both teams has been outstanding.
Good throw by Mac Driver. He had his receiver, but last second there,
4th and 5.
Tipped away, looked like, by the Freeport corner.
Edmond has been everywhere on defense. I mean, he's playing a great game offensively, but Joe, I think I'm more impressed with him defensively so far in this game.
Yeah, you have a great point there, definitely. He's come up with some big tackles and some great pass defense right there.
So here we go, folks. 4th and 5. This is a big one with 1:57 to go in the first half. If you were with us earlier in the game, Floyd had a 4th and 2 from the 6, and they weren't able to convert, and they need one here if they want to put up some points in the first half. So we'll see what Paul Longo has up his sleeve here to get the first down. Not that far to go. 5 yards from the 33. Got Clinton set up on the bottom of your screen. Now he comes in motion. Driver on the fake. Looking up top. And he's got Silva wide open. Silva to the 20. Silva to the 10. And finally wrestled out of bounds at the 5-yard line. What a heads-up play by Mac Driver to find his running back in the flat, and Silva did the rest.
Yeah, absolutely. They were running a bootleg now to the right side. Nothing open across the middle, and last second just tossed a little pass out to Silva in the flats and picked up a big gain, first and goal.
And a nice catch by Nick Silva, and to do the rest with it sets up his team inside the 6-yard line. First and goal from the 5 is where they put the football, and Floyd is in business, looking for their first LIC against Freeport ever. Down 4-0 in this series. Believe it or not, they have championships, but never against Freeport. Looks like the Colonials will call their second timeout of the half, and we'll reset here. Joe, how big is this opportunity for the Colonials to get on the board here before halftime?
Huge, because they score here. If they make the extra point, go in, you know, 7-6, be uplifting for the team, definitely.
I mean, we talked about this at the open. We talked about it in this entire half. Do you think all week long this team has heard about how they haven't beat Freeport? Some of these players were obviously on this team 2 years ago that didn't beat Freeport. Do you think that's in their head, some sort of revenge to get on the board against this team?
I'm sure there's such a huge football program with a great history that they've heard about it. But knowing Paul Longo and his staff, I'm sure they told the players, you know, just be concerned about, you know, today's game and what they can control.
Floyd is looking for their first LIC since 2012. When they beat Farmingdale 31-14. As a matter of fact, it was back-to-back LICs for them in 2011. That was a great game at Stony Brook against East Meadow. That was a 54-47 final for Floyd. So they're trying to get their first championship here in about 6 years. And first they'll have to get this touchdown on the board. First and goal from the 5. Driver is under center for the first time, I think, all day today. Silva's the deep back. He gets the ball, and Freeport is right in his hip pocket. Justin Lescouflair in on the tackle. And again, we talk about that Freeport defense. There it is.
Yeah, it's tough. They went double tight, full backfield. And, you know, all you're doing is just bringing in those great athletic Freeport defenders who can really fly to the ball.
So Coach Longer is going to have to come up with something here to get this team into the end zone, because, you know, when we get this far into the red zone, Freeport, they get stingy, Joe. They really, they stiffen up.
It's tough, you know, when you're calling an offense. Usually whatever got you down to the end zone, you know, near the end zone, you stick with. But there they change formation, and it cost them.
So Driver now is back in shotgun. And they do have a little trickeration. And they pass it in for the touchdown. Unbelievable. That's Eddie Longo in for the score from Jordan Clinton. Was that the Eagles play from the Super Bowl? Whatever it was, it works, and Floyd is on the board.
Great call. Great call. The perfect call. Freeport was flowing one way. They reversed it, and the runner might even be able to get outside, but he had a guy wide open in the end zone.
We talked about it, that Floyd was going to have to come up with something to get in the end zone because Freeport's defense has been so stingy, and that was the perfect call at the perfect time to get them on the board. So this extra point by Panichia can put them in the lead going into the locker room. It's no good. It is no good by Sebastian Panichia. So we have a tie game, and this has been an epic contest so far here in the first half. So there's 55 seconds to go. We've got a tie game, 6-6. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back right after this on the Varsity Media Sports Network.
To achieve financial success. They don't just talk
55
about
seconds to go here in the first half from Schuert Stadium on the campus of Hofstra University. It's Ben Turchin joined alongside Joe Mulligan here for the live stream. We thank you for joining us, and this has been a great contest, folks. The New York sports writers have William Floyd ranked 1 in the state and Freeport ranked 2 in the state, and it has lived up to the billing. As a matter of fact, I saw Greg Sarra write a piece in Newsday this week. Would this game live up to the hype? And I think he has his answer. It's yes. Panichia's kick end over end to be fielded at the 30-yard line by Freeport. That's Warren. Warren making some defenders. Nobody, he's got room. Out to the 50. One man to beat. He skirts the kicker. He's at the 30. And he's finally tackled at the 15-yard line. A flag comes in at the end. Oh, what a backbreaker for Floyd. Just as they tie the game up, Freeport with a huge play.
Yeah, interesting call with the pooch kick. You know, I understand they probably don't want to kick it deep to Freeport's returners, but now it's great field position for Freeport.
Let's get the call here. It's going against Freeport, so it will back them up a little bit, a block in the back. We just talk about Juwan Warren and some of the moves he just put on the Floyd defense right there. That wasn't fair.
Absolutely. They probably didn't expect that, you know, pooch kicking it, but they got playmakers all over the field, Freeport.
Freeport really has playmakers. You cannot underestimate. There are playmakers on both sides of the ball in this game. Just speaking about Freeport for a second, Jayvian Allen, Justin Lescouflair, we haven't mentioned Jordan Jackson yet, Arnold Cruz, if you go down and down, Terrance Edmond, Juwan Warren, Russ Cellan has a plethora of guys that he can give the ball to at any time and make a big play. It's. I bet you would love to have guys like
absolutely
that.
Yeah, and look in here, they got 43 seconds left, 2 timeouts, and I'm sure they. I wouldn't be surprised if they come up with some sort of trick play to put themselves back on top.
Well, they're inside Floyd territory with 2 timeouts, and we know they can make big plays, so I would say they're within striking distance right now of a score. And we thought the momentum was with the Colonials after that touchdown on a great fake play for the score. And who knows what can happen here in the next 43 seconds. So the Colonials have to buckle down on defense and stop the Red Devils here to go at halftime tied. This give is to Allen up the gut, and he makes a couple of defenders miss, and I think he has enough for a first down. We'll see if Cellan stops the clock. He will, with 33 seconds to go. 35. They stop the clock at 35 seconds to go. And he'll talk it over. So one timeout left. It is a first down. The ball's on the 33. So, Joe, let's reset this now. You only have one timeout. Freeport's a running team. You mentioned they could come up with a trick play here. What kind of play do you think Russ Cellan is thinking about here on the sideline?
With Terrance Edmond's athletic ability, maybe sprinting him out, getting him to the side, some quick short passes so that, you know, a receiver can work towards the sideline, stop the clock, and save that timeout for a critical moment.
So we'll see what Cellan devises here. Maybe the regular cast of characters for the Red Devils. Looks like Edmonds coming onto the field. Lescouflair is on as well. Jayvian Allen. And Jordan Jackson is on the field. So we haven't mentioned Jackson's name that much, but maybe this is the guy getting the ball on this play. We'll have to wait and see.
Absolutely. Floyd's probably keying on some other guys. And
Jackson has one-on-one man coverage right now if Edmond wants it. On the near side of the field. He looks like he's going that way. He's got all day long, and he's out. Allen's wide open in the corner for the touchdown. Joe, you called it a big time play. Allen was wide open. There wasn't a defender within 15 yards of him. And a big play touchdown for the Red Devils.
Yeah, Jordan Jackson looks like he ran a post. Both defenders went with him. And Allen was wide open.
Jayvian Allen is having some day through the air. Already 65 yards receiving. Tack that on for 33. He'll finish over 100 yards in the air. And this is a running team. Go figure. So the Red Devils take the lead back right after the Colonials score. This has been an unbelievable game, and we thank you for joining us today. 12-6, they're going to try for the extra point. That's Giovanni Martini. Snap is good by Edmond. The kick is up. It looks good. It is good. So with 29 seconds to go here in the half, Freeport back on top by a touchdown. It's 13-6. And with 29 seconds and one timeout, we'll have to wait and see what Coach Longo has in store to see if he can answer here in the first half.
Yeah, I guess it would depend what type of field position they have and if they really want to stretch the field and try and answer this quick score by Freeport.
Let me ask you this, Joe. Are you surprised that Freeport had held it close to the vest the way they have all first half? Because clearly they can open it up if they want to.
Yeah, I know Freeport wants to really run the ball, you know, get 5-10 yards that eventually turns into, you know, big plays, but doesn't surprise me now that they're, you know, getting the ball out in space to their playmakers.
And they have a bunch of playmakers, folks, as does William Floyd, and we're going to see some of the Colonial playmakers in a second. Nick Silva is going to be the deep back returning this kick, and you also have Jordan Clinton back as well. And at any point, the Colonials can put points on the board. Remember, we talked about this in the first quarter. The Colonials found themselves trailing last week at halftime, and it didn't faze them. They were able to come back against Ward Melville, and it was a larger deficit, 10 points. So this is nothing for the Colonials. They can easily get back into this game. It's only a 7-point margin, and who knows? They can get back into this game here on this kick return. We'll see what Russ Cellan wants to do, if it'll be a squib kick or if it's a kick deep. And Giovanni Martini, number 31, has the duties, kicking it off. Here we go from the 40, and it's going to be a squibber. Bouncing around at about the 30. It hit a Floyd player and bounced out of bounds. They got lucky on that one. Could have been scooped up by the Red Devils.
I like the kick by Freeport, putting it on the ground. You know, the ball's rolling around. You don't know where it's going, and it allows the coverage team to get down there, as opposed to what Floyd did in the air and allowed a big return.
They put the ball down at the 35.5-yard line, so Mack Driver's arm will come into play here. We'll see if they have any, if they have another trick play. They had a trick play for a touchdown. They're going to need another one here with 28 seconds in the first half if they're going to get back on the board. So we have some confusion by the officials. We're going to meet at midfield. I don't know if it's about the spot of the ball, if it's about how much time is left on the clock. We'll wait to get some sort of cue to resume the game. And it's been a good one, folks. We thank you for joining us on the Varsity Media live stream. Ben Turchin alongside Joe Mulligan, assistant coach with Baldwin, and he knows this Freeport team very well. So we're ready to play. 28 seconds to go here in the first half. Driver looking deep. He's going to go to Silva in the flat instead. That's a nice play. Silva could have went out of bounds, stays in bounds, and now we have a flag late. So he could have got out of bounds to stop the clock, but he tried for a couple extra yards. And the clock will stop on the penalty. We'll have to wait and see what happens here. Remember, Floyd has a timeout left. And it's on Freeport. Personal foul? And the crowd doesn't like it.
I'm not sure if there was a face mask on the tackle.
Well, this is a big break for the Colonials. We're going to wait and see what the official call is. It is a face mask. They're signaling face mask. So that should be a 15-yard penalty. And here we go. 15 yards tacked on to the catch, and we're inside Freeport territory now with a timeout to spare in 19 seconds. Crowd, you hear the boos from the crowd. They're not happy. Most of the flags today have come against Freeport. There's no two ways around that. This is a Suffolk crew, but they've been fair for the most part, calling it both ways. From the 43, Driver in shotgun. Going up top, that's Clinton. Edmonds on the coverage, and it was short. And a flag, they're going to call Edmonds on pass interference? Joe, I don't know on that, Joe.
Yeah, tough call. I think the receiver was trying to work his way back to make a play on the ball, and he was looked like he was boxed out by Edmond.
Well, the official's pointing that it was on Freeport. My mistake. So they're going to call it. The pass was short to begin with. It was a short pass. It would not have been completed. And I'm not sure what the linesman saw there. From up here, I didn't see anything. So that's a controversial call. It's another 15 yards or from the spot of the foul. And Floyd is gonna be set up here with 12 seconds to go.
Two plays on, and they got two fortunate penalties moving the ball inside Freeport's 30.
Coach Cellan from Freeport's going to call a timeout. I like this timeout to settle his guys down, because who knows where their heads can be right now. That was great coverage by Edmonds. And, you know, we talked about him a lot in the first half. First of all, the coverage by both sides in the air has really been outstanding. Allen's catches, he's been wide open, so there's no coverage to speak of. But when the quarterbacks have thrown the ball down the field, the corners have been right there, Joe. They're tremendous athletes on both sides.
Both sides, the coverage has been great. Now, probably Coach Sellen's calling timeout here to get the right personnel on the field and remind them, no one behind you.
What's interesting is the ball is on the 28. They didn't spot the ball closer to where the penalty happened. So if they're putting the ball on the 28, that's a break for Freeport. I don't know if they're going to be moving the ball or not. Probably not. So it'll be first and 10 from the 28. Floyd still has a timeout, but they've got work to do, Joe, here, because the clock is not their friend right here. So I don't know if they have a pass in the flat, get out of bounds. I don't know if they can try a field goal to put some points on the board. It's still kind of long distance for a field goal try, but they need yards and they need it quick.
Yeah, you can go two ways, you know, two plays, try both in the end zone, or, you know, like you said, get something short, get upfield, get out of bounds, and then work your way for the last play into the end zone.
So here we go. They do have a timeout. Remember that. It's first and 10 from the 28. Driver steps up, looking left, being pursued, has a man open, and it's deflected. Once again, Terrance Edmond. Who else would come in on a deflection than number 14 for the Red Devils? He has been the star on defense. No two ways around it. And now we have 5 seconds left here in the half on the 28-yard line. This one has to go into the end zone.
Yes, absolutely. So, you know, look for Mac driving, maybe rolling out to one side to give him some time and get all the Floyd receivers in the end zone. Try and come up with a big play to end the half.
So let's see what Coach Longo has up his sleeve for this last play of the first half. It's been a great first half. The Colonials are trying to tie it up again. Driver, it's a pass in the flat. It wasn't seen by Silva. They're going to get another play. Silva never saw it. He was running his route, never turns around. So it was a pass went short, but they will get one more crack.
Looks like Floyd might have been going for a hook and ladder. They had number four, Devin Brown, running a curl. I think Silva was trying to run underneath, but too much pressure. Mac Driver couldn't get away a good throw.
Floyd calls their last timeout, so they're going to talk about this play. And from the 28-yard line, you don't have many options. You can go right into the end zone, but I would think Freeport's going to be waiting for that. Or you could try the plays in the flat and see if you can break a couple of tackles.
Yeah,
what's the better option
here? I
think
we'll probably go for the end zone. You know, obviously you want your Floyd receiver to come down with it. If there's a defensive penalty, they'll get another chance at a play.
It's been a great game here, folks. So, you know, we talk about this rivalry. It's a little bit of a rivalry because they faced each other so many times in the LIC. This might be the closest game between the two teams so far. This is their fifth contest. You have to go back 2 years ago, Freeport won 28-14. You go back to 2010, Freeport won 62-25. In 09, it was 38-14. And all the way back in 2003, it was 40-7. So we have a one-score game in this one.
Yeah, very close game. No score here. We'll go into halftime, only a touchdown separating the two teams, setting up a great second half.
And, Joe, if you're the Colonials and you are, and this is the score that holds in the half, we'll ask that in a second, how you would feel if you were the coach going into the locker room if you were trailing 13-6. But let's not get ahead of ourselves. Here's the final play of the half. Driver rolling out. He is going to look for the end zone, and it's going to be intercepted by Freeport. Makhai Jinks with the pick. No damage done. Floyd will Freeport can't return it, so that's the end of the first half. The score is 13-6. Freeport will take a 7-point lead in the locker room. But now I'll ask you, if you're Floyd, last week you were down by 10, this week you're down by 7. Does it faze you at all here after the way you played in the first half?
No, you know, they got to talk about what they can correct. You know, the one touchdown drive they had, they went, they spread the ball out. They were running the ball well. So I would look for Floyd getting back to something like that, spreading it out, getting the ball up the middle to Nick Silva.
And if you're Freeport and you're Russ Cellan, what are you saying to your guys at halftime right now?
They correct some of those penalties, you know, that made it a little harder in situations. They'll be more efficient on offense. Not that they weren't in the first half, but, you know, keep spreading the ball out to all those playmakers. Let them do their thing.
So that is our score at halftime. Freeport 13 and William Floyd 6. Plus, Joe, we've been entertained to a very good first half. It's a half that saw William Floyd possibly take a lead on an extra point, which would have been the first time Freeport trailed all year. Roger Rubin from Newsday told us that a moment ago. So they're very much in this game. Freeport's going to get the ball right here to start the second half. They could open it up on offense, or we could see some more great defensive play here. What do you see in store here in the second half?
Yeah, Freeport receiving the ball. They can put a drive together. It could really make things difficult for Floyd, especially the way the Red Devils' defense is playing.
Absolutely. Some first half stats here. We talked about Jayvian Allen through the air, 5 receptions, 90 yards, and a touchdown. As far as rushing, Terrance Edmond, a quarterback, 28 yards on 7 carries. And for the Colonials, Nick Silva had 12 carries in the first half for 45 yards. Mac Driver with 4 for 28. Receiving, Nick Silva had 2 catches for 34. So we are set here in the second half. That's fielded by Jayvian Allen up the right side. And he'll be wrestled down by Tyshawn Lopez, number 5 for the Colonials. And we're underway here in the second half. We thank you very much for joining us on the Varsity Media Sports Network. And another penalty, wouldn't you know it? That's kind of been our story here in the first half. The penalties have been flying.
Yeah, looking
get a push
like
on the back.
Pushing the back on Freeport. Yeah, that'll set him back after a decent return.
Stadium. They're illegally parked. Will be towed if they are not moved. If you are parked.
Doesn't seem to really phase Freeport, though. These penalties, they seem to come right back with big plays. They were able to do that at the end of the first half. And I'm sure we'll see a lot of the same thing here in the second half. And I'm sure we'll see a lot of fireworks from the Colonials as well with their lone touchdown coming on a little trickeration. And it was Longo in the end zone for the touchdown for the Colonials. And I'm sure we'll be treated to much of the same here in the second half. So it's been a very entertaining game. And really, you could say here, the best game in the Long Island Championships this weekend. Garden City, they haven't lost in 3 years. And they shut out their opponent in Suffolk County, Lindenhurst, in Class 2. Cold Spring Harbor yesterday, topping Shoreham Wading River. That was a blowout. And here's been our closest game as Edmonds takes it off the right side. Only a 1-score game here in this LIC. So we've been treated to a great game so far, John.
Absolutely. Great plays on both sides, and then we're in store for a big second half.
I think so, too. I think we're going to get some great play here from both teams, and who knows what will happen. Remember, we've really hammered this home, but the Colonials are looking for their first championship against Freeport in an LIC. They're 0-4 against Freeport. And they're trying to get their first one against this team. They have successes in the LIC, but not against Freeport. 11:20 here in the second half, just getting going. 2nd and 7 from the 17. Edmonds lines up in shotgun, and that's Lescouflair in motion. And Edmonds going to look to pass. Has room, has a receiver, and it's broken up, almost intercepted by Greg Trett, number 7, in his hands. That was intended for Arnold Cruz. Could have been a turnover there by the Colonials.
Wow, great coverage. That would have been a big play for Floyd to start the second half with an interception in Freeport territory.
So it'll be 3rd and long. 3rd and 7 from the 17-yard line. Freeport has been able to convert on these plays. It has not fazed them in this game. Little option. Edmonds has plenty of room to run, And let's see, did he get the first? Great tackle by Jordan Clinton. I think he may have saved the first down. The officials are signaling that it is a first down, but I don't know, from up here, I didn't think it was, but I guess it is. So it'll be a Freeport first down. But again, you talked about this in the first half. Floyd makes open field tackles. If they don't make these tackles, Freeport is going to the house.
Yeah, all year. That's a big gain for Edmond, and great closing speed by Clinton. I thought that was going to go for a lot more than it did.
Floyd's defense has been able to keep Freeport at bay offensively. First and 10 from the 24. We're under 10:50 to go here in the third quarter. Edmonds tries the right side. He'll keep it himself. Nothing doing that time. Great penetration and the tackle made by number 22, Jazade Hall, for the Colonials. And it'll bring up second and long. We have not seen Freeport open it up like maybe we expected them to do here in the first half. They've shown the ability to do that, but they're still playing close to the vest. Does that surprise you at all?
No, it doesn't. You know, I know Coach Cellan likes that run-first mentality, and he figured, you know, if he can come out and show that against Floyd, he'll put them back on their heels.
So it's second and 9 from the 25-yard line as the clock continues to roll. And we've seen that in this game, that both teams are methodical, they take their time, and they don't rush to the line of scrimmage. Edmonds off the shotgun, on the left side, has a receiver, sails through Allen's hands, incomplete, and it's another third and long for Freeport.
Yeah, good play design, roll out, but went through the hands of the receivers. Maybe got a first down. If not, it would have been third and short.
So it'll be third and 9 from the 25-yard line. Russ Cellan is the head coach for Freeport. He's the offensive play caller. He is walking down the sideline. You can't see it on your screen at about the 20-yard line, calling the plays in. And that's where Terrance Edmond, the junior, he's played in this game before 2 years ago against the Colonials. And this game has not been too big for him at all. He has been a star today, both offensively and defensively. Ball in his hands, and the Colonials are swarming. About 7 William Floyd defenders, Nick Silva, one of them. Number 22, Jazade Hall. We've called his name a couple of times. How about Greg Trent? He's in on the tackle as well. And Mac Driver. So they really pursued to the football on that play.
Floyd came out second half to play some defense. Great pursuit there. They had a missed interception, but rallied after that. Now they put Freeport into a long fourth down.
And we'll see what Cellan does here. I would think they have to punt the ball. It's fourth and 11 from the 23. So Edmonds is going to indeed kick it away. And the Floyd Colonials are lining up at about the 50-yard line. That's Thomas Verga, number 17. And looks like Clinton, number 6, looks like is also back there for the punt. It's a high snap, but Edmonds able to field. It's a line drive kick, and it bounces. Let's see. Does it touch a Colonial? It doesn't. Freeport's going to let it roll all the way to about the 36-yard line of the Colonial. So, Joe, let's give them credit. They came out at halftime. They had to stop Freeport. That's exactly what they did, and they get the ball back here to start.
Absolutely. Great defensive stand by Floyd. Now they get the ball back, and let's see if they try and run the ball, you know, on Freeport.
Like we said, in the first half, the Colonials had success moving the chains 20-20, no problem, driving it on Freeport, and this is the best defense in Nassau County. They give up less than 10 points a game. But the Colonials just have to punch it in. They have to score, and they have to convert on these fourth and shorts. And that's really the difference in the game, if you think about it. If they convert on some of those fourth downs, they might have the lead in this game.
Absolutely.
And they have great field position. They spot the ball at the 40-yard line, 41, so it's first and 10. And that's where the Colonials will go to work for the first time here in the second half. Mack Driver, the senior quarterback, will lead the show here for the Colonials. And Nick Silver, number 23, is your tailback. We're going to line up here as the side referees get back in place. And Driver calling signals. Keeps it himself. On the run pass option, not much doing. Tackled there by Gerard Smikle, one of the captains for the Freeport defense.
Yeah, I'm not surprised Floyd spread the ball out there. It's still trying to run up the middle, but great play by Smikle to stop it for no gain.
What's interesting is we've seen both teams open it up at times, but most of the time play close to the vest. Keep it away from the other team, milk the clock. That seems to be the way these two offenses want to work here in this game. And it's been a fast-moving game because the clock has been running most of the time. Trips right top of your screen. Silva's still the man in the backfield. And Driver will call out the signal. He's going to keep it himself. Looking downfield. Has a man wide open. And it sails through his fingertips. Ronell Thomas had an opportunity at around the 30-yard line. There were three Freeport defenders. The ball sailed a little wide.
Yeah, great throw by Mack Driver. His receiver stopped on his route. He keeps running. He's still running into the end zone.
So a missed opportunity by the Colonials on that play, but they have had chances in this game. Third and nine from the 42. 7:45 to go here in the third quarter. It's a fast-moving game in the Long Island Championship. This is Class 1, the number one ranked team in the state of New York. William Floyd, the number two ranked team in the state of New York, Freeport. It is a heavyweight battle, folks, and we thank you for tuning in on this live stream. So we'll see what Coach Longo has in store on this one. It's same formation. This time the trips are to the bottom of your screen with the three receivers. Driver has pressure. Looking, Silva open, and it's enough for the first down. Great job by Driver, who was able to maintain his composure and find Silva. And Silva's doing a nice job as the release valve here in the flat.
Oh, great, great reaction catching that ball. It wasn't an easy throw, and reaching up, grabbing it, turning up the sideline, he got a first down.
Remember, it was Silva who had that nice catch that set Floyd up at the end of the first half down to about the two-yard line where they scored on that touchdown. And here he is again on a big third down moving the sticks. And we talked about this. Floyd has been able to do this on the Freeport defense.
Yeah, Mack Driver likes rolling out, and it's not a bad safety valve throwing the ball to Nick Silva.
First and 10 from the 43 of Freeport. That's Clinton in motion. Silva off the right side, and Edmonds puts his head down. They're gonna get a flag on it. Can that possibly be on Edmond, or is there possibly holding there? Because that looked like a nice tackle.
I would say holding from where.
Man, this Terrance Edmond kid, you can't say enough good things about him. Only a junior, the quarterback of this Freeport team, both offensively and defensively. He has been everywhere for this team on defense. So it is against Floyd. It's going to back them up, and they've been having a nice drive, so that's a little bit of a setback for them. Edmond had four tackles in the first half and some pass breakups. It did seem like he was all over the place in the first half for the Red Devils defense. So that's a backbreaker, Joe. They were moving the sticks. They had some momentum, and now it's going to be second and long, first and long, and that's not a position that the Colonials want to find themselves in.
Right, exactly. So now, you know, let's see if they go back to spreading the formation and rolling out with Mack Driver.
He's had success. He's got his man Clinton top of your screen. And keep an eye on Silva, number 23. Driver steps back. Clinton going deep up top, and it deflects off of the Freeport helmet, number two, Jayvian Allen. If it doesn't hit Allen's helmet, Clinton may have a touchdown.
Yeah, I think he just ran a simple seam route up the field. Driver throwing it up there, just a little short.
Nice pass play. So we'll bring up second and 20 on the incompletion. But Clinton is a nice-looking wide receiver for the Colonials. He's really had some separation, Joe. I mean, he could have a big game here in the second half.
Yeah, and I like that, you know, Floyd's taking the chances, throwing the ball deep to come up with the big play.
No, we talked about opening up this game. They've played so tight to the vest, both teams. And now we're seeing Floyd throw it up. Got to spread that defense out some way, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Now they're coming out, three receivers, you know, second and long.
Freeport with pressure, and down goes Driver. Nothing doing there. Let's see who came in on the sack. Looked like that was number 53, Troy Seraldi. And a bevy of other Freeport defenders as well. Looks like 52. Makhai Jinks was in on the tackle. Jinks with the interception to end the first half.
Great job containing there by the Freeport defenders. Floyd ran a little fake read action there, and it looked like they were going to throw a bubble to their back, but Mac Driver had no time to even get the throw off.
So it's third and 22 from the 45-yard line. We'll see what Floyd can come up with here. Look out for a screen. Nick Silva is the tailback. Fake to him. They're going downfield, and it's caught. That's number 88, and he's got room all the way in for the touchdown. Matthew Wagner, the senior wide receiver, has put the Colonials within 1 point, 13-12. What a play by the Colonials.
Awesome play. They went to the single receiver side, man coverage, and Wagner just went up, made a great athletic play, took off for the end zone.
We've been talking about this entire second half, third quarter, opening up the offense, and Floyd did just that, and a nice pass by Driver, the senior quarterback, who's had some nice throws today all day long, and he connects. And I believe that's Wagner's first catch of the game, and it's for a touchdown, a big one. So this extra point by Panicia would tie the game at 13. It's up, and it is good. And with 6:25 to go in the third quarter, we have a contest. It's the Red Devils 13 and the Colonials 13 here on the Long Island Championship on the Varsity Media Sports Network. Welcome back. Ben Turchin alongside Joe Mulligan, assistant coach with the Baldwin Bruins, who knows Conference One Nassau County very well. And Joe, have you seen Freeport all year in a position they're in right now?
No, not at all. You know, usually their starters were out by halftime with a big lead. And we talked about it earlier. You know, if they face some adversity, how are they going to handle it?
And we're going to get our answer momentarily as Panici is set to kick it off from the 40. A nice booming end-over-end kick. And that'll be fielded at the 10 by Allen. Allen to the 15. Makes one defender miss. Still on his feet. Has running room. A flag is thrown as he takes it out to the 39-yard line. This one will probably come back a few yards.
Yeah, great return. But, you know, if this flag's against Freeport, it's going to set them back for their starting position.
Floyd already signaling, at least they believe that it's against Freeport. Really, to me, doesn't matter where they start with the football. They're so electric, and they can move up and down the field if they open things up on offense. But here we are, folks. We talked about it. This could be an epic game. This is a revenge game for the Colonials, and they're in it. Their crowd is into it. They're pumped up. And the Freeport Red Devils, they have not been in a situation like they're in right now all year long. They dominate teams. Their starters, like Joe said, are usually out at this time. They don't play in the second half. How would they handle adversity? They haven't had this happen to them all year. But I got to believe that Russ Cellan has prepared them for this because William Floyd is that good of a ball team.
Yeah, I'm sure Coach Cellan is definitely prepared. But, you know, when you're in the moment, things can get tight and hectic, so let's see how Freeport reacts.
Well, the question is, are they going to open up the offense or continue to do what they have been doing, which is the runs, the RPOs, keeping the ball in Edmond's hands, and then picking their spots? So we'll see what Russ Cellan wants to do here. From the 27-yard line, it is Edmonds. He fakes, and a nice open field tackle. Once again, Greg Trent, number 7. Colonials have done that all day.
Yeah, right back to Edmonds on the ground, but not much there. Great tackle, like you just said.
And that's one thing the Colonials have shown us. First of all, both teams are playing excellent defense. There's just, you can't say that enough. The pursuit to the football has been outstanding. The coverage downfield has been outstanding. Outside of the big pass play to Wagner, that's really been the only huge completion with coverage. The two defenses really showed up in this one, and now it's 2nd and 9 from the 28. And we're still waiting to see if Russ Cellan is going to open up his offense. One thing they are doing, though, is they're holding on to that clock. They are waiting that clock to tick down. They are in no rush to snap this ball. And we're under 5:30 to go here in the third quarter with a tie game. And Coach Cellan not happy from the sideline. He's going to call a timeout. It's the first timeout here in the first half. So he didn't like what he saw there from his team. And he wants to talk it over.
Yeah, a couple late play, last seconds, and players are shifting over. And I'm sure Coach Sellen's pretty mad that he's got to use a timeout this early in the second half.
Joe, we called Jayvian Allen's name quite a bit in the first half. He just had that kick return before the penalty, but we really haven't called his name offensively much here in the third quarter. You think we might see some of him here coming up on the second and long?
Yeah, with the big first half he had receiving, I'm surprised they haven't got the ball out to him in space. And, you know, that's something we should look forward to coming soon.
Jayvian Allen had 5 receptions for 90 yards and a touchdown in the first half. And we haven't really called his name on offense here in the third quarter. Freeport's only had 1 possession. Floyd did a very nice job getting down the field on their opportunity here a moment ago, and we find ourselves in a 13-13 ball game. The Long Island Championship is on the line in this game. Both teams undefeated, and William Floyd is the lone undefeated team in Suffolk County. Hills West will play after this. They have a loss this season. Floyd does not. What a tackle that time by number 23 for the Colonials, Nick Silva. Big time play. And it'll bring up third and long, and Edmonds comes up limping a little bit.
Yeah, they're really sticking with Edmonds running the ball, which surprises me with all these playmakers on the outside.
I think that is somewhat of the storyline offensively for Freeport, is playing tight to the vest. It's almost like Russ is only going to open it up if he needs to, and right now he doesn't. They're in the game. The clock is moving. It's third down. Now they're going to have to, you'd think, pass. But he's not trailing this game. Allen in the backfield. 2 receivers. Allen on the fake. Pressure. Edmonds looking. Throwing. Lescouflair catching. And a first down at the 41-yard line. Brought down by Jordan Clinton. Another open field tackle by the Colonials. Let's talk about Edmond. He kept that play alive.
Wow, great job escaping pressure. It's very hard for a quarterback sprinting one way and throwing back against your body across the field, but he did there, finding Lescouflair.
They are playmakers, and they are proving it yet again here in this game. Edmonds, not much running room here. A little bit of a jump. Silva pushes him out of bounds at right about the 45-yard line. It'll bring up second down for Freeport. Clock will stop, 4:18 in the third quarter. You know, I'm seeing, Joe, some of the Freeport players with their hands on their hips, and we talked about that they don't play the entire game. Could conditioning be a factor here for the Red Devils?
Yeah, I know Coach Cellan, you know, probably conditions a lot during practice, but there's nothing like game condition. So, you know, playing 4 quarters now couldn't and set in on the Freeport Red Devils.
From the 45-yard line, 2nd and 5. This is Warren, and he'll be close to a first down. Tripped up at about midfield. That was Keith Winfrey, the defensive lineman who got him down, and we'll see where they spot the ball. One thing we notice here with Coach Cellan is he's now giving the ball to all of his playmakers. It's not just Edmond. We saw Allen touch the ball. We saw Lescouflair touch the ball. And now we see Warren touch the ball, so he's getting his guys involved here in the third quarter.
Yeah, definitely. You know, as great an athlete as Edmonds, you keep running with him. You know, you don't want him going down and having to leave the game.
And I wonder how much of this philosophy by Coach Cellan is to wear down the Colonials, to keep them on the field defensively, and just to wear them down. Because I don't. If we look at time of possession, it's got to be in the hands of Freeport this game.
Yes, definitely. That's what comes along with the running attack.
Edmonds will keep it on the left side. There was penetration by Driver. They're going to get holding on Freeport. Nice penetration there by Mac Driver, and that's going to back Freeport up 10 yards.
Yeah, Mac Driver's strength and ability to get upfield caused that holding penalty against Freeport.
So another setback for the Red Devils here, and we'll see if the Colonials can capitalize. It'll be first and long, third and long, rather.
Freeport, the indication is holding.
Freeport has seemed to answer these calls. In third and long, they seem to find a way to make a play, whether it's through Edmonds' arm or his feet or to any of these receivers. They seem to complete the necessary yards. Now we're going to have an official timeout. And I'm not really sure what is going on here.
Yeah, the referee was pointing to the scoreboard.
We have a hold on Freeport. That's the call. And we do have an official timeout. You're right. They are pointing to the board. Unless they're going to change the time. It's showing 3:20.
Yeah, they put back 12 seconds on the...
They put back 32 seconds.
32.
So 3:52 is going to be shown on the clock. So here we go. Third and 13 from the 37. Freeport's in a long passing play. Pressure right up the gut by Winfrey. Edmonds avoids. Warren with a nice block on Winfrey, giving Edmonds some time. Allen down the field. Edmonds going to keep it himself and run out of bounds at the 40-yard line. Nice pursuit there by Jordan Clinton. A lot of moving parts on that play, but the end result is we're going to have fourth and long.
Yeah, Warren picked up the blitzer, which I thought was going to give Edmond time, but way too much pressure by Floyd causing him to roll out of the pocket.
And that was some block by Juwan Warren, number 21, on the far side of the field. Edmonds had time. Allen broke free, but Edmond never found him, or at least elected to keep it himself. So here we go. Freeport, who didn't punt at all in the first half, is now going to punt for the second time in the third quarter. And that is a storyline that is developing here, folks, as the Floyd Colonials have stopped them defensively, and they're going to get the ball back here with 3:40 to go in the third quarter. Edmonds the punter. And Vargas fields at the 30 and wrestled down at the 35. Lescouflair puts him to the ground. Thomas Verga with the return, and we have a flag on the field again.
Yeah, it looks like it's going to be pushing the back on Floyd.
This is an officiating crew that has not been shy about throwing the flag around today, that's for sure. Happened to Freeport last return. It's happening here to the Colonials. It'll be first down, and we'll see where they spot the ball. 3:32 to go here in the third quarter. And this is a quarter that has not seen Freeport score yet, folks. Freeport had a 13-6 lead at the halftime. And this entire third quarter, they have not scored. This is a team that averages 41 points a game, Joe. Both teams averaging 41 points a game coming into this contest. But these defenses are unbelievable.
Yeah, Floyd made some adjustments at halftime, and their defense in the second half has been outstanding.
So they spot the ball at the 25-yard line. It'll be first and 10 from there. And for the first time all game, the Colonials have a chance to drive for the lead. But we've said it before, this Freeport defense is relentless, and we'll see if they're up for the task. They are getting the crowd going here on the home sideline. Take our word for it. The Freeport faithful are up cheering on their team, and we'll see what kind of defense Russ Cellan deploys here. On a first and 10 from the 25, driver and shotgun, Silva up the middle. Not much doing there. The defensive line snuffs it out. And Miles Norris involved again, along with Gerard Smikle. We've talked about him a couple of times, the captain on the defensive side. Dakarai Stevenson was in there as well.
I want to point out, Makhai Jinks read that play well, too, from his middle linebacker position.
Clock running at 3 minutes and 13 seconds. Second and 8 from the 27. Floyd in the huddle. They're not in any rush to come to the line of scrimmage. We've got a good one here, folks, from Shewart Stadium on the campus of Hofstra University. It's the Class 1 LIC. Driver to Clinton. He can't hold on. Nice defense by Jordan Jackson, number 5, the senior defensive back. Broke it away, and that stops the clock, 3rd and 8.
Yeah, Floyd just trying to throw a simple slant pattern, but Jordan wouldn't allow the receiver to come down with the catch. Freeport needs to stop here.
And the Freeport crowd yelling defense, defense, egging them on. This will be a big stop for the Red Devils. It's a 3rd and long for the Colonials, and they need a first here. This is not 4-down territory. They're deep in their own side of the field. Not deep, but from the 27-yard line, you don't want to risk it and give Freeport back the ball with a short field. So this is a big, big third and eight from the 27 with 2:50 to go in the third. It'll be Driver stepping back, looking. Doesn't like what he sees. Now firing downfield. There's coverage, and it's caught. What a completion. Devin Brown with the toes. Man, he had two of them in there. NFL-style catch. And the officials have not determined yet if it's good, or at least they haven't signaled. Now they're going to say a bobble?
Wow.
They're going to call it that he bobbled the ball. It looked like it was good. We don't have instant replay, but it looked from here like he caught it. But the officials have a much better vantage point than we do. So a great effort, but incomplete.
It looked, from our point of view, looked like he dragged both feet. His back was to us, so maybe a referee had a better angle and saw that he was bobbling the ball.
There was a flag on the play. It's against William Floyd. Freeport will decline it, of course, and he'll bring up fourth and eight from the 27. Very impressed with Mac Driver, by the way. Able to buy some time, stay in the backfield, not get too pressured, look downfield, and that was a really impressive throw right there.
Yeah, he was able to escape the pressure. Good throw down. A great job by the receiver coming back for the ball.
You see Driver stats on the year, 10 touchdowns in the air, 10 touchdowns rushing. He's an offensive powerhouse for the Colonials. Sebastian Paniccia to kick it away. And there are no Colonials there on defense, so Allen has a lot of room. Nice little shimmy out to the 41-yard line. And that's where the Red Devils will take over. 2:29 to go here in the third quarter. We're tied at 13 in the Long Island Championship, Class 1. We'll take a timeout. Back with more after this on the Varsity Media Sports Network. And welcome back. 2:29 to go here in the third quarter. As we left, the officials threw a penalty on Freeport, so that's going to back them up off of the punt return, and they'll take over on the 28-yard line. I don't think we've seen a kick return where there hasn't been a flag today, Joe.
No, absolutely not. A lot of holdings in the, a lot of holding calls in the second half.
So the Red Devils are going to look for their first scoring opportunity here in the second half. And they are still waiting to get the call here from Coach Cellan. That's Dakarai Stevenson, number 12, who will call in the play. And now all kinds of confusion, as now we see Jordan Jackson line up wide. Here we go. Now the Red Devils are setting up. Edmonds calling out the signals to his offensive line, calling the protection. And he's looking for Jackson, who has the completion past the 40-yard line for a first down. So Cellan's going in the air that time.
Yep, switching it up. Nice slant route, good throw, good catch, first down.
First and 10 from the 42-yard line. Edmond to Lescouflair, waiting for blockers. Sheds a few defenders, and he's broken free, folks, and nobody's going to get him. A 42-yard touchdown run for the Freeport Red Devils, and they retake the lead, 19-13. We had an injured Freeport Devil on the ground, but he's okay. That was number 59, Jayden Jackson, but he got up, so he's okay. And we've talked about it. They break big-time plays, and we saw it right there.
Yep, just another example of someone different doing it for Freeport. Lescouflair did not stop on the play. Looked like a couple Floyd defenders. You know, the initial contact looked like he was going to be down, but two moves and he was gone up the middle.
And my mistake, I said a 42-yard run. That was actually a 58-yard run. A 58-yard run for Lescouflair, who provides a big-time spark for the Red Devils when they needed one in this tie game. And the extra point is good by Martini, and the Red Devils go back up by 7 with 2:06 remaining here in the third quarter. I guess you can't keep Freeport down that long, Joe. I mean, we talked about they average 41 points a game. They're on the board now with 20 and a big play here by the Red Devils.
Yeah, the first two drives, they ran the ball, had no luck, had to punt twice, came out on their third possession in the third quarter. And, you know, they started off with a pass and went hurry-up offense after that, caught Floyd off guard.
Well, one thing that Russ Cellan hasn't done is he hasn't bailed on what he wants to do in his offensive philosophy. He stuck with the run. He did open up a little bit there on a pass, but this is what Freeport does, and this is what the Colonials are going to have to stop if they're going to win this game.
Yeah, absolutely. Multiple weapons. You don't know who's getting the ball. And now Floyd has to answer with their own drive.
They trail by 7 with 2:06, but they've been able to answer the call in this game a couple of times. And we'll have to wait and see if they can do it again here in the third quarter with 2:06. 3 timeouts remaining for the Colonials. Freeport called an early timeout in the third quarter. They're down to 2, but they have the 7-point lead. It'll be Martini to kick things off from the 40-yard line. And looks like deep to receive is Zion Washington, number 27. First time we've mentioned Zion Washington's name. And here we go. Martini's kick. End over end. Washington's going to field it at the 20. Cuts back to the left side. 3 Freeport defenders meet him right there. Number 7, Arnold Cruz, was the first to greet him. Nice coverage by the Red Devils. And the Colonials will go to work on offense here for one more drive in the third quarter.
Very difficult to get outside Freeport there. Too much speed.
7-yard return. Colonials possession. Their own 26.
So here we go. 2:01 to go here in the third. The Colonials have to answer the bell once again. It's been an up and down battle for William Floyd, but they are in this game. They have yet to take a lead, but they have tied it. From the 26, 1st and 10, they line up with 4 receivers. Silva is the tailback. Silva gets the ball. Not much doing out to the 30, a gain of 4.
Looks like he might have tripped on his own there.
Clock continues to move in the third quarter. 1:44. William Floyd not in a get to the line of scrimmage, just like Freeport. Both of these teams methodical. Calling in the play, executing it the way they want, and there's no rush from either side. Same formation. We've got 2 receivers top, bottom of your screen. Silva is the tailback once again. He's been the tailback all game. That's Clinton in motion. And it's Silva up the middle. And a nice gain out to maybe the 35-yard line. Should bring up 3rd and short, maybe 2. And that's where the Colonials want to be, 3rd and short. Clock continues to run here. We're just under a minute in the third quarter. It's been a very fast-moving game.
Yeah, very fast. And, you know, I like what Floyd's doing. They're spreading out Freeport, but still running behind that big offensive line.
We'll see if the Colonials can get a playoff here before the third quarter expires. They should be able to get one more. And it's a 3rd down. Freeport crowd is on their feet, folks, trying to get one more stop here for the Red Devils. And that's Clinton in motion. Driver steps back, has a man in the middle of the field. That's Clinton. Clinton breaks a tackle at the 50, and Cruz wrestles him down at about the 47. That's another nice throw by Mack Driver.
Yeah, awesome job. Floyd really likes that quick reverse boot and dragging the backside receiver. Mack Driver's been on target all day with that throw.
Mack Driver has been very impressive as a quarterback today, folks. And let's give some credit to the offensive line for the Colonials. Joe, we've talked about how good and relentless the defensive line is for Freeport and their linebackers. But the Colonial offensive line has given Driver time to throw.
Yeah, Mack Driver must love pulling on a bootleg behind number 67, Kyle Musselman. You know, when you have someone in front of you who's 325 pounds blocking for you, it makes it a lot easier.
Absolutely. That's the end of the third quarter. Folks, don't go anywhere. We are being treated to a spectacular Long Island championship game. We'll come back with the fourth quarter after this. It's the Red Devils 20, the Colonials 13 here on the Varsity Media Sports Network. And we start the fourth quarter with the Colonials, first and 10 from the 47-yard line, trailing by 7. Clinton in motion. And this is Lopez off the right side, but Cruz is there. Boy, Cruz, the past few plays, has been a man on a mission for the Freeport defense. Arnold Cruz, the junior linebacker, and he wrestles Lopez to the ground. Tyshawn Lopez, the junior running back for the Colonials. He picks up only a couple of yards. It'll bring up second and long for William Floyd. Joe, we talked about Mac Driver and how impressive he's been offensively today. He's completed 7 of 16 passes for 163 yards. Really nice day. Nice effort by him today in a touchdown.
Yeah, and most of his throws have been on target for big plays, keeping drives alive.
There was a loss of one on that play, so it's 2nd and 11 from the 48. Here's Driver again, buying time, finds Silva. Silva wrestled to the ground by Gerard Smikle, and he'll be shy of a first down, so it'll be 3rd and short. Nice open field tackle by the Freeport defender, captain senior linebacker. And now we have a stoppage of play. This could be detrimental for the Colonials. It looks like Nick Silva is on the ground and hurt. We're going to have some of his coaching staff come out to take a look at him. And we'll step aside here on the injury with a timeout. We'll be back right after this on the Varsity Media Sports Network. And some unfortunate news, as Nick Silva could not get off the field on his own power, helped up by a coaching staff. And he is not in the game right now, folks, so we'll keep an eye on that. That is a storyline developing right here as Clinton is met in the backfield. Gerard Smikle, once again, a loss of at least 3 yards on that play. It'll be fourth down, and there you see there a give to Clinton, and they're missing Silva right on that play.
Yes, Michael did his job, contained. He read the jet sweep and absolutely devastated the Floyd runner.
Yeah, we need to talk about the previous play as Nick Silva, their running back for the Colonials, it's hard to tell from up here the exact extent of the injury, but Joe, during the commercial, he was not able to walk off the field. His coaching staff had to help him get off
the field. Yeah, the fact that he couldn't put any weight on it. Now I see him on the sideline. He's sitting on the bench with his helmet off, so at a critical point in the game, to lose someone like him is big on both defensive side, too. He's been all over the field on defense, too.
He has been instrumental for this Colonial team today, and that's a big loss. And the William Floyd Colonials, they take a timeout on fourth down. Joe, what do you do here? You're down by 7. There's plenty of time in the game, 9:49 left. It's a 4th and 5. If you don't convert here, Freeport gets the ball in your territory. What do you think Coach Longo was thinking about right here?
Very, very difficult decision. You know, the way Mac Driver's been, rolling out, finding his receivers, you can go in that direction. You know, you punt, pin him inside, you know, maybe the 15, 10-yard line, let your defense take over, you know, could be a good option too. So let's see what it looks like. Floyd's going for it. They got their offense out.
They're on the plus side. They're in Freeport territory. It's 5 yards, and you mentioned it before. But, hey, Nick Silva's not on the field right now. And that's your go-to guy. That's his release valve guy in the flat.
Good point.
And you don't have that. Now, you do have Jordan Clinton, number 6. And he's been a really nice receiver and another option for Mack Driver. And then you also have Matt Wagner, who had the big-time catch for the touchdown. So he can go to other players. We'll have to wait and see. 4th and 5. He's looking left for Wagner. Wagner has it for the first down. A nice slanting. He brings it down to the ground at the 31-yard line and points for the first down. So, big play. I guess you go to number 88.
Yeah, great call. Mac Driver faked a handoff, quick handoff to Tyshawn Lopez just to draw the linebackers up. And they threw a slant to Wagner backside off of it.
So, a big first down pickup for the Colonials. They're inside the 30-yard line. And they need a score to tie this game up as the clock ticks down, 9:34 to go. Driver in shotgun, and Tyshawn Lopez is filled in for Nick Silva. Driver looking up top again for Wagner, but that's going to be too far into the end zone. And it'll bring up second and long.
Great coverage by Jordan Jackson there. Didn't give Wagner any room.
So the developing storyline here is Matthew Wagner. Here's a senior wide receiver, and Wagner had the big touchdown catch for the Colonials, a 55-yard bomb from Mack Driver. And now Driver has looked to Wagner's side two plays in a row, and I guess he feels comfortable with him now that Silva's out of the game.
Yeah, tough not to look his way, you know, with the big receptions he's had.
Wagner lines up at the top of your screen, and there's man-to-man coverage. Jordan Jackson is right on him. And on the fake give, Freeport not fool. Driver nothing doing on the second and 10 play. It's going to bring up third and long. And, Joe, I can't help but say this. It seems like Floyd is missing a big piece right now. They're not sure what to do because their big back is out of the game.
Yeah, Silva's their go-to guy on a lot of their offensive plays, and it seems like Floyd's a little flustered. Where to put the ball.
Yeah, very unfortunate to get that injury. Silva was playing great in this game before he got dinged up there. 49 yards receiving, 55 yards rushing, over 100 total purpose yards, and now you lose him what appears to be for the rest of the game. Third and 12 from the 31. Driver going up top, looking for Clinton. Clinton has separation, and he has the touchdown. A 31-yard bomb. It's Driver again. Unbelievable.
Awesome throw. He's been on target all game. Great route by Clinton, and they're an extra point away from tying the game.
Now, you have to give a lot of credit to the William Floyd Colonials. They have been trailing this game a bunch of times, and they continue to come back each and every time. And Mack Driver has been as impressive as advertised, folks. Just throwing darts all over the field. That time connecting with Clinton on a 31-yard bomb. And we are an extra point away from a tie game once again.
Good coverage by Freeport. Just a
better
throw and catch.
Much better throw.
Better throw and catch.
Much better throw. Panicia on. It's blocked on the extra point. Big play by Jordan Jackson. And that could be a crushing development for the Colonials, coming right through on the block, and that keeps the lead in for Freeport 2019.
Jordan, he was untouched from the edge, and no problem at all blocking that extra point.
Just when you least expect it, this Red Devil team comes up and makes a play. Lescouflair on the 58-yard run, Jackson on the field goal extra point block. When you let your guard down is exactly when Freeport comes and they make a big play. That's the difference in the game.
Yep, and that's what I'm sure Coach Cellan tells his players. Every play is important. You can't let up.
Well, this game is far from over, folks. It's 8:18 to go in the fourth quarter, and the Colonials are only down a point. They've held Freeport to one score in the first half. Both of these teams average 41 points a game. So even though it's 20-19, it's still anybody's game here. And we'll just have to stay tuned for how this develops, because it has been, we've been treated to a great, great contest.
Great game. And we'll have to see if Nick Silva comes back on defense and how that affects.
If he comes back at all.
Yep.
Nick Silva, number 23. I'm sure all the William Floyd fans know about him. For the Freeport fans, number 23. And you know, he left the game in the last drive, and we'll see if he can get back onto the field. Right now, he's not on for special teams. And there you go. That's what you lose. You lose 553 yards and 10 touchdowns of offense in the season. And he's already, we talked about it, he already has over 100 yards, 55 rushing yards in the game and 49 receiving yards in the game. And those catches, by the way, three receptions, those aren't down the field catches. Those are dink and dunk catches for the quarterback when he needs an escape route. That's what he's been there. So we have to wait and see how that's going to develop Colonials.
Those catches extended drives on third down, you know, to keep possession for Floyd.
But I would say in his absence, Mack Driver has really stepped up, and also Jordan Clinton has really had a good game himself. Now three catches for close to 90 yards on the day with that touchdown. So Jordan Clinton doing a nice job as well. They have deep threats. William Floyd has deep threats. They can get back in this game in a heartbeat. Panicius kick that may go out of bounds. Freeport's going to prevent William Floyd, and I don't see a flag yet.
No, I think the Freeport player actually kicked the ball out of bounds before it went out of bounds.
I missed that.
Yeah, yes, you're allowed to do that, so, you know, no flag on the play.
The referee did signal that. It was touched by the Red Devils by mistake, so they will take over on offense, 8:18 to go, and this is where the – you had mentioned it. Silva plays defense as well, so they'll miss him on defense. But really up front, this is where the Floyd defense has to get going here. They cannot let Freeport get much on offense.
Yeah, they need someone like Keith Winfrey or even Mac Driver causing a turnover to get the ball back for them.
And it's 18 seconds remain in the fourth quarter, and this Class 1 Long Island Championship game. Class 3 gets its time in the spotlight beginning at 4:30.
So here come the Red Devils on offense. They've got the one-point lead, and they've got the ball. Here comes a flag, and it came in the back in the secondary, and we didn't even have a set play yet. It's been a strange day for flags. I'll tell you that much. It's been very strange. I don't know if we had an illegal substitution because we are going to march Freeport's way for 5 yards. Illegal substitution, possibly?
Yeah, I'm not sure. It came from the backfield, Judge.
Well, he saw something that we didn't see, and our head referee did not signal a call. So, in any event, it's still 1st and 10 on the 29-yard line for Freeport. With 8:18 left in the game. Edmond in shotgun. And we've got two receivers towards the bottom of your screen. And Edmond's going to throw in the flat. That's Allen. And the pressure is right in his face. What a job that time by number 40 for the Colonials, Mike Tarry, and number 11, DJ Bennett. They were not fooled on that play.
No, not a great pursuit by both of them.
Loss of 4, 2nd and 9.
You know, that's a play that might work for Freeport in the regular season. But they really met their match here defensively with the Colonials. They have made every open field tackle you could ask them to make in this game, and they've held Freeport to 20 points. So it'll be 2nd and long. Freeport showing the same formation. Edmonds this time is going to keep it himself, and again, not much doing. Jordan Winfrey making a play. Keith Winfrey, I apologize. Keith Winfrey making the play, and it'll bring up 3rd and long. Clock moves, 7:17 to go. 3rd and 10 from the 24. This is a big play for the Colonials. Stop Freeport here. You get the ball back. Chance to take the lead. What does Freeport have in their bag of tricks on this one? They have been stopped twice in the second half, by the way. They have been forced to punt 2 times in this half. It'll be Edmonds in shotgun. Looking downfield, looking for Allen, and it's overthrown. A little bit of bump and contact, but really it was good coverage. It wasn't a catchable ball. So once again, the Colonials hold Freeport, and they will force them to punt. And now, for the first time, they can take the lead.
Yeah, great job by Greg Trent on that coverage. It looked like he almost wanted to jump the pattern and go for another interception.
Well, I don't know that they're 100% punting yet. It does seem like they would, but they are also looking at Coach Cellan on the sideline for a call here. It's 4th and 10 from the 24. Now Edmond goes back, so he will punt. And the Colonials have 2 men back to receive. Edmond's kick is a good one. And it's bobbled and picked up finally by Thomas Verga. That could have been interesting. But give him credit for at least maintaining possession of the ball. And they still have good field position on their own 40-yard line. And that's where they're going to take over. So, Joe, this is a chance here now for the Colonials to come back on offense without Nick Silva and actually with a touchdown or a field goal take the lead.
Yeah, defense did their job. Now they got the ball back. Let's see if Mac Driver goes for that big play again.
32, Eddie Longo, he caught the touchdown pass in the first half. He's in the game, so we'll see if he's replacing Nick Silver as a tailback. And it looks like we had another penalty as they're moving the ball back on the Colonials. They'll spot it at the... Boy, was this a personal foul?
Yeah, face mask against Floyd on the return.
Wow, all the way back to the 26-yard line. So what could have been the 40 and nice field position, and now they're all the way backed up to the 26. So here we go, 6:45 remaining in the game. Trailing by one, the Colonials on offense. No Nick Silva, but plenty of playmakers on the field for Mac Driver. And that's Tyshawn Lopez, and he's driven backwards. Makhai Jinks with a nice tackle, and we'll see if he gained a yard.
Taken down by two Jayvian Allen.
You almost have to think, Joe, that the clock is running here. If they don't score and Freeport gets the ball back, it could be over.
Yeah, things will definitely tighten up if Floyd has to punt. So
each team has two timeouts to go, but the clock continues to roll, and Floyd down one. They have to move. Keep an eye on Jordan Clinton.
You would think they'd be a little more urgent, but they're taking their time.
Unless they don't want to give Freeport the ball back. I wouldn't want to give them the ball back either. Clinton and Wagner deep. And Driver looking for Clinton, but it'll sail out of bounds. Good coverage by Edmond once again. And now the Colonials are in a third and long situation.
Simple fade route by Clinton, but that probably was Mac Driver's worst throw of the day. Ball was in the air way too long. Luckily, it sailed out of bounds.
Well, the Colonials in a third and nine. I don't know if we're in four down territory yet, but with 5:50 to go, they're not going to have many more chances in this game. Especially with the way Freeport likes to milk the clock. So this is a big play for the Colonials at the 27-yard line. We've seen Driver go to Wagner in these situations. We've seen him go to Clinton in these situations.
Yeah, look for the they like that little bootleg rollout with Mac Driver just to buy him some time.
This Clinton Edmond matchup on the bottom of your screen. Now he'll come in motion, but that keep your eyes on that matchup. Driver and nowhere to go with the football. That should be a flag, and a flag will come out. Intentional grounding. Nobody was around the area, and he forced that one out of there, so they're going to get them a loss of down.
Yes, correct.
And the Colonials will have to punt. So give Freeport a lot of credit on that play. They came with the pressure, and they caused a very big play.
They're going to lose some yards there, too, so they'll be punting further back than if it was an incomplete pass.
Well, I think the story for William Floyd has been their defense and limiting Freeport to 20 points. They're going to have to do it one more time. I mean,
that is it.
There's no two ways around it. If they are going to win this game, they're going to have to stop Freeport one more time. I hate to say this, but one more big play by the Red Devils, one more score, and that could be it. So, once again, the defense for William Floyd is going to have to step up if they're going to win this game. And that's Allen at his 50-yard line. So Freeport's going to get great field position and a nice kick. So there'll be no return. Goes out of bounds at the 40-yard line. And that's where Freeport will take over. We'll take a timeout. 5:42 to go in this game. It's a great one. Freeport 20, William Floyd 19. Back right after this on the Varsity Media Sports Network. Ben Turchin alongside Joe Mulligan for the conclusion of this game. Freeport from the 40. That's Edmond, left side, breaking tackles. He's still on his feet out to the 21-yard line. So some momentum here for the Red Devils. Clock will stop, but not much left of it here in this game. And the Colonials have a lot of work to do on defense here, Joe.
Yeah, no surprise. Coach Cellan right to the ground attack. Only thing he would like better is maybe if his run has stayed in bounds there.
But it is a first down, and they are up one. Allen in the backfield, and we have a side. Do we have a sideline warning? We have a sideline warning. Ready to resume. Edmonds going left side, keeps the ball. Clock will run. Brought down by Andrew Minnelli, number 18, the junior linebacker. And now we're under 5.5. And it's second down, 2nd and 8 from the 20. Joe, is this four down territory for Freeport? Or is it a field goal?
Great question. You know, I would say if it was fourth and short, fourth and a yard, fourth and two, maybe go for it. Looks like Coach Sellin's keeping the ball in his quarterback's hands. Let him do his thing and just churn that time down.
Would you expect him to put the ball in the air right now?
That would surprise me.
So here we go. Allen in the backfield. It's Edmond. He's been holding on to the ball, and he's going to stay. We have a flag. Another flag as Edmond come down at the 15, so it'll be third and three pending the penalty. And it doesn't look like Russ Cellan likes the call. But let's get the official ruling. If this is holding, this is a big break for the Colonials, and it looks like it is holding. Holding on the Red Devils, what could have been third and short, milking the clock, is now going to be second and long.
Yeah, and you can tell by the way Edmond was running, he wanted to stay in bounds, you know, set up a third and short. But now's a situation where, you know, it wouldn't surprise me if Coach Cellan, you know, wants to take it a shot at a big play.
Right, because now you're looking at second and 18, and the ball's on the 30-yard line. Clock is stopped. No, clock is running, rather. Excuse me. Clock is running. So here's Edmond off the right side. And he'll get a couple of yards. Gets a couple of yards back, but it's still going to be third and long.
Taken down by one, Max Liver.
That penalty's big, too. Definitely, you know, we take them out of field goal position if they were ever going to think about it, if it was
right.
You know, third and fourth and short.
.347 left in the game.
Gain of three on the 27. Third and 14.
Third and 15 from the 27. Oh, almost a bobble on the snap. Allen has it, and great pursuit to the football, and he's finally wrestled down by P.K. Kite. And that's a big play. It's going to bring up fourth and long, and immediately William Floyd calls a timeout. Joe, honestly, what do you do here for your Freeport? You're out of field goal range. It'll be a very long try for a fourth down. Do you punt him and pin him back deep?
You know, I know in the past Coach Cellan is lined up to go for it. Maybe look for a quick kick, something like that. If not, maybe he'll just go for it, try and pick up the first down.
So William Floyd is down to one timeout after that call, which was the smart play to stop the clock. And now it'll be interesting. Now it's on Coach Russ Cellan to make a decision here that will affect the outcome of this game. If you punt and you're successful and you pin the Colonials deep, it's a long field to work with, although they only need a field goal to win the game. If you go for it and you don't get it, the ball will be on the 31-yard line for the Colonials, and that's not terrible field position. I'm sure Coach Longo would like that.
Yeah, not bad at all. You know, and Mac Driver's been throwing the ball deep. You know, he's got some good receivers to throw to, so not a bad starting spot if it is there.
So let's see what happens. Coach Cellan talking it over with his team. And I would be surprised if they don't punt the ball here, because, you know, it's such a low percentage play on 4th and 20. Although they do have game breakers and playmakers and all that. But if you don't get it here, you're really giving the momentum back to William Floyd. So I would expect a punt. And Edmonds is lining up. Well, it could be a quick kick, like you said. He's not far deep enough for a punt. It does look like they're going for it. And Coach Cellan is on the field barking plays to his quarterback. So, Joe, they're going to go for it. They're going to try for the first down. I guess he figures even if they don't get it, it's almost as good as a punt. It's almost as good as a punt. Edmonds actually looking for the first. He's got time. Wide open receiver, and it was deflected by Lescouflair. If he doesn't deflect it, Cruz may have had a touchdown. But Lescouflair didn't know Cruz was behind him.
Exactly right. I don't think he knew he was there. He was just trying to make a play on the ball.
That was an unfortunate break for Freeport.
All I saw was Lescouflair wide open.
Wow, so that means a turnover on downs, and William Floyd will take over. Down by one with 3 minutes and 14 seconds at the 32. They have moved the ball, but can they at least get a field goal, get into field goal territory, or come up with a touchdown? This is what we've been waiting for, folks. This has been an unbelievable game, and we thank you for being a part of it with us. Driver to Clinton drops the ball. Would have been an 8-yard gain, dropped the ball, so now it's second and 10 with 3:11.
Yeah, it looked like an easy, you know, throw and catch, uncharacteristic drop there.
This could very well be the final drive for the Colonials. If they need to punt the ball back with one timeout left, I'm not sure they have enough to stop Freeport. So this could be all four down territory here for the white and green from Suffolk County, looking to stay unbeaten, looking to beat Freeport for the first time in their history in a Long Island championship. Down one with their senior quarterback at the helm. Driver drops back, being pursued, throwing it up. It's tipped. And that may have been complete to Wagner if it wasn't for the deflection that time by Makhai Jinks. Makhai Jinks has come up with some nice plays on defense.
All day long. Yep. Realized he wasn't getting in there, but, you know, he got his hand up to deflect the pass.
And just like that, it's third and 10 from the 32 with 3:06 to go. It has not come easy for William Floyd. They've been able to persevere, but it has not come easy. And they're going to need a couple of big plays here. Will it be Wagner? Will it be Clinton? Will it be Lopez? We'll have to wait and see. Third and 10. Lopez goes into the flat. He's wide open. That's Lopez. Tyshawn Lopez. And he takes it out to the 50-yard line. Finally wrestled down by Smikle, but not before a big first down and another good play by Mack Driver.
Great play call. Great throw. Keep move the chains for William Floyd.
That would have been the play that Nick Silva would have come up with. So Lopez filling in nicely for their star running back. That was a huge catch for the Colonials. And they're in business now. Clock running under 3 minutes at midfield. First and 10 from the 50. The give to Lopez. Gains a couple of yards before the Freeport defense swarms at the 45. Looks like he picked up 5 yards. So it'll bring up second and 5 from the 45-yard line. We have an injured Colonial on the ground. Danny Riley, one of the offensive linemen. His helmet is off. Clock will stop at 2:40. And we'll see the severity of the injury. Looks like he's okay.
He will have to come out for a play, though, even just because his helmet came off.
So here comes 72, Anthony Tomish, to replace the injured player for one play. He seems fine, though. The helmet is in his hands. He's ready to go back in on the next play. So we'll keep an eye on that. Ball spotted on the right hash. And clock is moving. So 2:33 and counting. Could be the final drive of the game, folks. Buckle your seatbelts. We are in for a great final. Second and 3. Driver back looking. It's going to be a hold on William Floyd. Detrimental call as Driver was looking to buy some time. And from second and 3, we're going to have second and 13.
Yeah, Dakarai Stevenson and Tristan Saab, great penetration there, causing that holding call.
So the Colonials are going to have to answer yet again here. They've had plenty of chances to do that and have answered. And now we'll have to see what Coach Paul Longo has in his play calls on second and 13 with 2:17 to go in a game, trailing by one. This is unfamiliar territory here to the Colonials. They've never trailed in a game this year this late in the game. They trailed last week by 10 at half and came back to win the game. But this is the longest in a game that they've trailed, and this could be the final drive of their season. An undefeated season, a Rutgers Cup and a Long Island championship on the line. Driver looking left for Wagner, has him open, didn't go his way. Instead, he went to Thomas, and it's incomplete, Joe. On the far side of the field, Wagner was wide open.
Wide open. He was wide open. Still a good throw to Thomas. He just didn't come down with the pass.
And Thomas is down. I'm not sure if he got his if he got nicked up coming down on, as he was in the air making the effort and came down hard. So we'll have to check in on that injury. And we'll take a timeout and come back right after this. 2:12 to go in the game, 2019. Don't go anywhere. And it's good to see Thomas come off the field on his own power. He should be okay. But it sets up a 3rd and 19 from the 41-yard line. This will be a very big play for the William Floyd Colonials, goes without saying. There were opportunities on that previous play. Wagner was open. Driver didn't see him. And so it's possible they can go right back to Wagner on this play. It's two down territory, folks. Floyd needs a first down. Got to have it if they want the championship. Driver looking right side. Has Clint. It's intercepted. Edmonds has it at the 40. Setting up blockers. And he'll slide down at the 20-yard line. And that could be it, folks. An unfortunate turn of events for the Colonials. I'm not sure if Clinton slipped. Didn't see the ball. It went wide, but Edmonds played center field, Joe. He was right there for the pick.
Yep. He was wide open. Just a little overthrow there by Mack Driver. I think, you know, Floyd was just trying to get, you know, some of the yardage back because they had so far to go. But that Freeport defense with a big turnover.
A massive turnover. We have an injured player on the field. We're going to step aside back right after this. And we're back. Good news. Tyshawn Lopez was able to walk off the field, so looks like he'll be okay. And Freeport will take over on offense. There was a penalty, I guess a block in the back there on the return. So they'll get the ball on the 42-yard line after the Terrance Edmond interception. No two ways around that. He's the MVP of this game, folks, for the Red Devils. And he has the ball and shotgun. With 2 minutes to go in this game, the Colonials need a turnover. Winfrey with the tackle at about the 44, a loss of a yard, and Coach Longo is going to call a timeout here. It's his last opportunity to stop the clock, and it comes with 1:56 in the game. It'll be second and long. Joe, what can the Colonials do to get this ball back?
They need, you know, first guy going for the ball wasn't a turnover. First down by Freeport, the game's over now that, you know, Floyd has their last timeout call.
They did back him up by 2 yards, so good pursuit there by the Colonials. But yeah, this is going to do it, folks. If they can't get the ball back, they can't stop the clock. And Freeport, can Freeport kneel at this point to end the game? I don't think so. I think there's too much time on the clock.
Too much time left.
Too much time left, even though Floyd can't stop it. But they could force them into a couple of mistakes, try to get the ball back, because that's going to be about it right now for the Colonials. This has been an unbelievable game, folks. We thank you for joining us on our first ever live here at Hofstra University. It was a pleasure to bring the game to you. My name is Ben Turchin alongside Joe Mulligan. We thank Joe. We thank you for joining us today, providing some great insight on, and we've been treated to a great game.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity. This is awesome. Awesome game, great plays by both teams, and still could be a ways to go.
So 2nd and 12 from the 44. Edmonds is going to keep it. They're not going to do anything too crazy. Winfrey trying to get the ball out of his hands. He cannot. He gets back to the line of scrimmage. So now we're at 3rd and 10. The clock is rolling. And you're talking about maybe William Floyd getting the ball back with about 20 seconds left, assuming Freeport punts.
Yeah, and that'll be tough. You know, no timeouts. They'd have to break a big play.
First things first, stopping Freeport here on 3rd and 11. And you know Freeport will let this clock go all the way down. They have two timeouts. Coach Cellan can actually call a timeout, which I'm sure he will, when the clock gets down to 1 or 2 seconds. And indeed he does. So there's the timeout for the Red Devils. They have one remaining, and we're at 1:11. So after this third down, you're looking at roughly 20 seconds, 20, 25 seconds.
Yeah, and sure, Coach Sellen's telling, you know, who's probably going to keep the ball in Edmund's hands. Make sure you stay in bounds, and we can run out the clock.
Obviously, a first down, the game is over for the Red Devils. If they don't get it, I would assume Freeport would punt. We've seen them go for it, though. They can go for it once again.
Yeah.
try to end the game that way.
Coach Cellan could use some more time, call his last time out, you know, and then decide what he's going to do on fourth down.
But, correct.
You know, punting the ball and, you know, making Floyd go, you know, 80, 90 yards with no timeout, you know, is very difficult.
Talking about Terrance Edmond for a second, and I read you his stats of this game. 47 yards on the ground, 157 yards in the air, and an interception in this game. He has been unbelievable, Joe. If Freeport is able to eke this game out, I would think he's the MVP.
Yeah, absolutely. He's done it all.
This is a kid that's a junior, played in this game 2 years ago, captain quarterback of this team, and he's only getting better. So he'll line up in shotgun. And there's three receivers lined up for Freeport. Edmond to the right. Winfrey once again gets him to the ground with 106 to go. Great job by Winfrey. He's had some great tackles today.
Yep, absolutely. I'm sure Coach Cellan now is telling the official, you know, with a couple seconds left in the clock, play clock, to, you know, probably take his last timeout.
He will take that timeout with 1 second to go. We don't know where that 1 second is. They don't keep a clock on the field, so we're not exactly sure where that will be, so we'll find out momentarily. And then you would I keep saying you would think, but it's not for sure that they'll punt the ball. You would expect them to punt the ball. And at this point, Joe, talk to us about putting on a punt block. There's the timeout with 29 seconds to go. So we said around 20 seconds, and that's what Floyd will have. Talk to us about how do you put a punt block on, what do you need to do for a punt block, and then if you don't put the punt block on, if you're Coach Longo, and you go for the return, what's the strategy there?
I'm sure Floyd will have a punt block, max protection from the Freeport side, and, you know, Coach Cellan probably telling his punter, you know, get a quick angled kickoff, you know, try and pin them, you know, inside the 20, make them have to drive farther down the field.
Is there any way Freeport doesn't punt here?
That would surprise me. You know,
fourth and nine.
If they were inside maybe the 25, but, you know, if they can get a good punt off and get 30, 35 yards, that's much further that Floyd will have to go.
So the odds are Freeport is going to elect to punt the ball, and we have to wait and see what William Floyd will do. Will they put the punt block on?
Unless Freeport just lines up in their offense so that Floyd can't put a punt block on and try that quick kick.
Well, Floyd does have a returner. Clinton is back, number six, at about the 18-yard line. So they expect the punt. And it does look like they're going to be coming.
Here's the quick kick.
There's the quick kick. Clinton comes up to field it. And he'll be brought down at the 30, right at the 20-second mark, which is
interesting,
what we said.
They're only gaining about 10 yards. Great play by their kick returner, well, safety at that point, to come up and make a play. He almost broke that.
Yeah, he did almost break it. We've seen crazier things in high school football, folks. Don't go anywhere. Don't go get that drink. Stay right here. 20 seconds, no timeouts. This is it. This is the Long Island Championship. Everything is riding on the line. The closest game these two teams have ever played in an LIC, and it comes down to this. Can Mac Driver find some magic right here on the shotgun? Going deep, and he just sails it a little short of Clinton.
They're running an out pattern, hoping to pick up about 15 yards, get out of bounds, stop the clock.
16 seconds to go. Keep an eye on 88. That's Matthew Wagner, has a 55-yard touchdown catch in this game. Keep an eye on 6. That's Jordan Clinton. Driver stepping back, being pressured, throwing up to Clinton. We have a flag. What could that be? Two officials are pointing somewhere, looking. Holding, it looks like.
Holding, yeah.
Looks like a holding call on Freeport.
Receiver was trying to get upfield, and 54.
Gerald Smikle.
Gerald Smikle, wasn't letting him go. That might be the better, though. The alternative could be a big play for Floyd.
That's true. And it's better than pass interference. So it'll move the ball up to the 40-yard line with 11 ticks on the clock. The downs really are not. It's a first down, but that really doesn't matter at this point in the game. The clock is the enemy. The big play is needed right now. Driver up top, looking for Clinton. Intercepted, and that's going to do it. Jordan Jackson, number five for the Red Devils. As the clock expires, folks, and that will do it. The Freeport Red Devils with their fifth Long Island championship against the William Floyd Colonials, who played their hearts out today. The final score, 20-19, could have easily been a win for the Colonials. They have nothing to hang their heads down for. They played exceptional for Coach Longo. Joe, I'm sure you would agree, we were treated to an unbelievable game.
Epic game. You know, as expected, the big-time players on both sides stepped up throughout the game. It was just, you know, Freeport's day, and they came up with the bigger plays. And a couple of them were on defense, interceptions late in the second half.
Yeah, the storylines for this game is defense, and both teams came and showed it because their offenses averaged 41 points a game, and the final score was 20-19. So as you can see here, this was a defensive battle, and really what it came down to was two extra points. Really, when you think about it, two extra points. One was blocked and one was missed. It could have been a 21-20 final, William Floyd.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. Yep, special teams played a big part today on a couple occasions.
So the final score, once again, the Freeport Red Devils, as they did in 2016, defeat the William Floyd Colonials for the LIC. Final score, 20-19. We're going to step aside for a second. When we come back, we'll do the awards presentation here at Hofstra University for the Class 1 Long Island Championships. Back in a moment, right after this, on the Varsity Media Sports Network. Again, welcome back to the campus of Hofstra University. Our final score in the Class 1 Long Island Championship, the Freeport Red Devils 20 and the William Floyd Colonials 19. We're going to send it down to the field with the award presentation by the end zone on the visitor side.
2018 Division 1 County Champions and the Long Island finalists here today. Congratulations on a great season.
Just want to say it was a great game by both teams. Two of the two best teams in the state. Very proud of William Floyd for a great undefeated Suffolk County Championship and a hard-fought game today. And to Hotel Cellan, congratulations to Freeport on a hard-fought win.
Section 8 Athletics and the Nassau County football coaches congratulate William Floyd. You guys had a phenomenal season, and today was a game that will go down in history as one of the best LICs. Congratulations to you guys. You're champions in every sense of the word. And now, it is my pleasure to present the 2018 Class 1 LIC Championship Trophy and Plaque. Coach Russ Cellan and the Freeport Red Devils. Hey, listen, the Floyd guys, you guys are no joke. I tell you, this was a great fight. Okay? This could go either way. Neither team quit. Got after both sides. I've never been involved. I've been coaching 32 years. I've never been involved in this fight. Right? Congrats to you. Outstanding job. My guys, you did everything you said you're going to do. We're all very proud of you. Thank you. Congratulations to both teams.
Folks, there you have it. Great sportsmanship on the end zone side over there. Coach Russ Cellan said it perfectly. Joe, I think you would agree. He said in his 32 years of coaching, he's never been involved in a game like this. And Matt McLeese of Nassau County said that this will go down as one of the greatest games in Long Island championship history. I think we both would agree.
Yeah, absolutely. This was two heavyweights today, you know, top two teams in the state. And they played their hearts out on both sides.
And, Joe, I just want to thank you again for joining us here on the live stream. It was a pleasure having you, providing insight from a coach perspective, and having some insight with Freeport. So hope you enjoyed it. It was a pleasure having you on board.
Yeah, thank you, Ben, and your great staff here at Varsity Media. This was an awesome experience, and I appreciate it.
Absolutely. For our entire Varsity Media staff, Chris, Ron, Matt, Sam, and Jeff. My name is Ben Turchin with Varsity Media. We have another game upcoming, the Plain Edge Red Devils and the Half Hollow Hills Colts. That game kicks off at